Hello and welcome to Canadian Tire Motorsports Park. The sun is shining and the enthusiastic fans have turned out in huge numbers because this is a track where you can feel the racing history. It was 1967 when Jack Brabham won the first Formula One race, and since then any driver worth their salt has tackled the track formerly known as Mossport. James Hunt, Jackie Stewart, Stirling Moss, they laid it all on the line to claim victory here. And this amazing track, it goes no easier on our young hotshots of today. So last weekend, the second half of this season kicked off at Watkins Glen with a vengeance. The track was amazing. The cars seemed faster. The on-track rivalry was more intense. It was incredible. Brilliant, as I like to say. So this is sports car racing. Right now, this is the IMSA WeatherTech Sports Car Championship. It is the best road racing in the world. That's what I'm talking about.
The first half of the season in the WeatherTech Sports Car Championship had exceptional moments at some of the most iconic tracks and races in the U.S. The second half of the season kicks off today at Canadian Tire Motorsports Park, a track renowned for sustained high speeds and the potential for epic triumph or failure. In prototype, the top three are just 7 points apart and fighting for every position. In GT Le Mans, Corvette Racing and Ford Chip Ganassi Racing have given the fans the rivalry they wanted, the teams combining to win 5 of the 6 races they've gone head-to-head in this season and sit 1-2 in points. Who will take the lead as we kick off Act 2? 4 classes racing side by side, all in for the win, and it begins right now on FS1. That huge crowd of knowledgeable and passionate Canadian fans are here because they know this track is a supreme challenge. And with 4 fast classes running at once, special things can happen. It's time for the Mobil 1 Sports Car Grand Prix. You know what, folks? This is one of those venues on the schedule that whether you're a competitor, whether you're a fan, whether you're a broadcaster, you just get extra excited about it. So special is this place. I'm Greg Creamer, delighted to be joined by 1987 Formula Atlantic winner here, Calvin Fish. And Cal, as we take a look what's unfolding here in the prototype division, there are only 4 races left for those cars. And as we look at the points, is it now a 3-horse race? And if that's the case, how do the 10 and the 31 close this up?
Well, it's shaping up that way, Greg, particularly with the number 90 having back-to-back tough races. With the point structure, it's very difficult to make up a lot of ground quickly. So first priority for the 10 and the 31 is you have to beat the number 5, simply. Then ideally have another team, possibly the Mazdas, getting between you and the 5 also to help increase that point swing. But Mazda have their own goal today, and that's getting their first victory.
And another thing that all of the competitors are talking about this weekend, Cal, is traffic. GT Daytona's back after missing last year and with much quicker cars. How big is traffic going to be in terms of an issue?
Well, this circuit's incredibly quick, Greg, and even though the GTD class is utilizing GT3 machinery with massive downforce and great cornering ability, the prototype's approach speed is simply incredible, and all the drivers will have to be on full alert today to avoid contact. This will be an intense race for all of the competitors.
And maybe the class right now with the biggest excitement is GT Le Mans as Chevy versus Ford. Man, that battle is getting downright tasty as Ford is closing down on the points lead Corvette has held since Daytona.
There's such huge buzz around the Ford GT, but let's not forget the tried and proven reliability from Corvette.
Here we go, this is GT Le Mans at its finest. Corvette goes 1-2 here at Daytona.
Corvette win again in GTLM.
Critical times, they look for their first victory with this new Ford GT.
Westbrook down to the inside, into the hip, and what a move.
Here it is, the first win of the Ford GT.
Joey Hand makes the move, can he make it stick?
Ford wins at Watkins Glen.
What a race, and 1-2 finish.
And it's now back-to-back wins for Richard Westbrook and Ryan Briscoe. But the battle we all hope to see when Ford announced their return to sports car racing was between Corvette and Ford. We've yet to see that unfold on the racetrack. But if you look at the results, the two have combined to win 4 of the first 5 races. You add in the 24 hours of Le Mans, and they've won 5 of the 6. Now, this week, there was some unprecedented balancing of the performance. And during practice and qualifying, we finally saw that battle come to life. In qualifying, it was Antonio Garcia who claimed the class pole position, but less than 0.04 of a second behind him was Dirk Mueller in the Ford GT. It's taken place in the marketplace for over over 100 years, but today we finally get to see it unravel on the racetrack, guys.
Oh, and how special it has been, and how special I think it's going to be. Now, courtesy of Google Earth, let's take a look at where this great track is just outside of Toronto. And Cal, as we look at our Ford track map, it's one of those venues that drivers describe in one word, mega.
It is. This is old school, mate. Breathtaking, both its speed and commitment needed. The first half of the circuit is like being on a runaway roller coaster ride. You are trying to hang on simply. The plunge over turn two is like accelerating whilst falling over a cliff. There's a slight pause in speed for turn 5 miles corner, then it ratchets back up for the run up the Mario Andretti straightaway to turn eight. Possibly a good overtaking opportunity there, then great flow through the S's to complete the lap, which is just under 2.5 miles. You have to put it all on the line here, but if you get it wrong, it will bite you in a heartbeat.
It is a special place. Here is our Continental Tire starting grid across the top. And again, all four classes racing here. We're completing the pace lap, and we are ready to go racing 2 hours and 40 minutes. And on pole, carrying those throwback colors to 1991, the Mazda Tristan Nunez, his second pole, but last year's pole winner along the outside. And we are coming to the green. Oh,
Taylor. It's a big jump on the outside of the front row. We get the green. Taylor's been so aggressive on these opening laps this year, Greg, but did he jump the start there?
I think that's what's going to be looked at. If he didn't, he timed it to perfection. And Cal, this is exactly what you were talking about. Taylor to the lead. Now watch the GT Le Mans start as it comes up from the pole. Corvette leads away and down on
the
turn.
Oh, there's a touch between the boards. Dirk Mueller and Richard Westbrook traded paint there on the approach to turn one. Fittipaldi a big first lap. Screen right, he's up to third.
We knew it'd be intense racing in GT Le Mans, but we didn't think it would be between the Fords this early going. Oh, Ricci in the Ferrari contacted the back of the 100 BMW, and it cost Ricci's car just a bit as the second of the Corvettes, the number four of Gavin, able to slice in to position Cal.
Fisichella trying to make moves there. See the two Porsches at the back of the field. They won here last year. That's the pace of development in GT Le Mans over the course of one season.
You see in GT Daytona pole sitter, that is Alex Riveras and the Team Seattle Heart of Racing Porsche on the pole, just in front of one of the Stevenson Audis, and that's how they run at this stage.
Things settling in now. Ricky Taylor, he wanted that lead. You could see as they came through that final turn. He touches the brake a little bit, exiting turn one. The grip was not quite there to run absolutely flat out that they will be when they get in the sweet spot. Nunez on a charge, looking for a way by, looking for the lead for Mazda.
Well, I think Nunez knows he needs to get to the front, get in that clean air before they get traffic and build up a margin. Once they hit traffic, Cal, the torque of those V8s and those Corvette DPs, we saw how that worked at the Glen.
Mazda just need a good clean race here. They have the pace to win this race here today. Nunez has been on fire, grabbing the pole position. On board with him now. Look at him fighting the wheel through Moss Corner. Then up this straightaway. About 175 miles an hour when they get to the top before they hit the brakes.
I'll go.
And it just continues to climb. It flattens out there, then you climb again. Then here you go, into eight. Another of the great corners here, Cal.
There's beautiful rhythm and flow through these final quarters, through the S's. There'll be some moves made there for sure in the GT classes throughout the day in that final corner as we get into the race's mentality towards the end of this 2-hour, 40-minute race.
This lead trio has opened it up just a little bit here as Tom Long, about a second and a half adrift to Fittipaldi right now. These three going for it hard and fast early.
Goossens has got around the 31 wheel and Corvette of Eric Curran. Goossens sits in the fifth position. Ricky Taylor, he said the starts and restarts are where he has the opportunities to make some moves this year, and he's been proving that.
Down through turn four, here's that pause in speed. I love how you put that, Cal, describing it. That's exactly what it is here in Moss.
Fittipaldi a little bit wide of apex there, trying to hang on to this lead duo. Long sits there in fourth in the second of the Mazdas. Then you see Goossens. Then you see Eric Curran. Then you see John Pugh.
And the Delta Wing running here as well. They just have not had the pace here and have already dropped off to the tune of about 4 seconds behind Pugh as Nunez again closes up, as you would expect, in turn eight.
Problem is there's so much apex speed around this first half of the lap, Greg. Unless you get into traffic, it is very hard to make a move.
Calvin, I just want you to think about something. The beauty of the Mazda operation is that they have two cars out there, two bullets in the gun, as we like to say. Tristan obviously is tasked with going flat out, but when it comes, and I know you're the master of working this out, to the final pit stop, it'll be on the amount of fuel you put in that could win this race. What if Long is running just a slightly more moderate pace so they can have a better strategy at the end of the race? I know that Jamie will have more on this story later, but I was just standing here thinking, this is a very fast run at the front, but maybe the fourth place Mazda is being a little bit more strategic.
Well, certainly the Mazdas have shown very good fuel economy through the first half of this season. And there's a real aggressive strategy that could be played here today. Essentially, with the prototype, they run about 45 minutes on fuel. It's a definite three-stopper in terms of pit stops here today, if it stays green. So really, the window opens up at about minute 30 to maybe make your first stop and make it to the finish.
As we take a look now, what's unfolding in GT Le Mans, just to let you know, folks, just got word race control is looking at that start. Nothing decided yet, but they're looking at it. But in GT Le Mans, Antonio Garcia, Cal, hard to believe that was the team's first earned pole since the Rolex 24 Daytona in 2015. It was Antonio's first pole since Mazda in 2014.
It is, you know, because they went on a tear last year, won four races in a row. But right now, we can see this Ford-Chevy battle that we've been licking our lips about for the last couple of years since Ford made that announcement back mid-season last year that they were returning to GT competition. It is now in full force here today. Yes, they run 1-2 in the championship, as Jamie mentioned, but we really haven't seen the battle on the racetrack until today.
Boy, Bill Oberlin made an absolutely superb start, didn't he? Jumping from fifth into third, getting around not only his teammate, Lucas Luhr, but also around the second of the four GTs. Great run there. And let's take a look at how this one worked here. Oberlin's outside move, Cal.
Around the outside. As Jamie said, there's been some balance of performance adjustments since the last round. The Ford has lost a little bit of boost. The BMWs were untouched since Watkins Glen, where they were truly competitive. Oberlin and Dirk Werner standing on the podium just a week ago.
You know what, the BMWs were fairly good here last year, Cal, with that short wheelbase Z4. This new longer wheelbase platform, I would think here, should be superb.
Oh, it's gonna be really good through those high speed, long duration corners. The longer wheelbase really helps that. This motor has really good torque. It seems to stall out a little bit at the top end, which I think is more aero than anything else in comparison to the Ford. But you can see there, Oberlin really not losing anything to Dirk Mueller in front of him. There's some great dynamics at play here. A lot of these drivers have driven on the same squads before. Certainly Dirk Mueller and Oberlin for BMW for many years.
We're gonna go back now and take a look at the start, Cal. Race control reviewed it and said no action, but watch
right here. Ricky tries to get a jump, and I think Nunez said, I'm not gonna go with him. Let's blow off this start, but the green flag waved anyway, and he then had to go. Fittipaldi got a good jump there as well.
As I said, it's been reviewed, no action. Everything is copacetic at this point as we hop on board again with the number 25 BMW from Rahal Letterman-Lanigan of Bill Oberlin, sitting third in GT Le Mans. Ricky Taylor leads overall. Garcia in GT Le Mans, Simpson in Prototype Challenge, and Ramirez in GT Daytona. What a venue it is as you ride on board with Tristan Nunez, second overall in a prototype. That is Ricky Taylor up front. Let's take a look at our WeatherTech weather. And it is a day as beautiful as this track is breathtaking. Mid-70s, low wind, low humidity, stunning skies. Doesn't get much better than that as we ride with Tristan as he continues to try and stay with Ricky Taylor. And that leads us into our keys to victory. And I'm excited, Cal. I've been trying to get this on the air for about a decade now. It's Poisson's three P's of performance.
I love it. Well, the first one is pace. As Jamie stated at the start of the show, latest round of balanced performance. We'll have to see how these changes stack up today. Position, track position is key. As we can see right now, it is tough to pass here for Tristan Nunez. So there may be some risk with strategy to try and get you that track position. Then you've got to have patience. Overtaking will be so difficult here today with all four classes competing in the WeatherTech Championship.
And here we go. That's now the leader. They have already gone through the entire GT Daytona field as those two drive by. Such is the speed here. And Nunez easily able to stay with Taylor, but as you said, Cal, getting around him is a whole different story. And he's shown the nose a couple of times, but it's never been anything that he can really attack with.
No, I think he's probably got two or three tenths in hand over Ricky Taylor right now, but having it and displaying it is a different matter when you got that car sitting right in front of you. He's also going to be having some of that downforce taken away from those front dive planes on the nose of his car. So he's doing a great job here. He is really displaying that patience and that poise. This young man is really coming alive in terms of his stature as a prototype driver here this year. Oh, he's now got the tools to do the job.
Well, that's a huge point, isn't it? When you lose the air on the nose, whether it's from wake another car or that patience thing you're talking about, tinking another car, knocking a dive plane off, it can start to really take a toll on the tires, and that just changes the entire dynamic of the pits.
Absolutely. You know, when you've got a fast race car, Mazda have had the pace to win a couple of these races this year. They haven't quite ticked all the boxes. They've been working on it. They've been really working on their driver changes, on their pit stop practice. But today is the day they can make it happen if they don't make a mistake, JB.
Calvin, just talking to Jordan quickly, I said, how's Ricky feeling? He said, well, he's really enjoying holding him up, really. He said it's hard work, but obviously they know that Tristan will be using more of his tire sitting behind. I know you guys just touched on that. So right at the front, Ricky's only job, he knows it's inevitable. Maybe in the pit stop that they could go by, but as he says it, he just goes by. But certainly did a good job holding out the front there.
That was traffic-induced, exactly what we talked about, Cal, and Tristan read it beautifully.
Well, Ricky committed. He dived to the inside of the apex for that final corner, turn 10, and Tristan Nunez saw it coming. He read it perfectly, just out-accelerated Ricky Taylor down that front straightaway. Mazda now leads.
And then listening in on the radio, one thing that Tristan Nunez has is a crew that has in his ear all the time. They have talked him around this track, telling him you're going to catch GT traffic next lap. You're going to be in a three-way battle in the next corner. Stay calm, stay calm. Every single move that he makes, the team is in his ear, making sure he remains patient and he knows what to expect. That's one thing that not all drivers want, but for Tristan, it's certainly working today. And his pit crew, he got a big round of applause after that move.
That's a great point, Jamie. Some people do not like to be talked to. Think of Kimi Raikkonen, maybe. But certainly a lot of guys like to know the big picture. They like to be talked through. Dan Binks does this on the radio with Corvette. Look at Ricky, just dives to the inside of the factory. Porsche there is held up a little bit, doesn't get the momentum off the corner. Nunez is alongside. Ricky can't block at that stage. It's too dangerous. And Nunez is through for the lead.
That's one of those classic examples, isn't it, that sometimes it's better to follow than lead when you get into traffic because it gives you the opportunity to read it. As we go back to this great GT Le Mans class battle that's unfolding, still Garcia leading right there in the number three Corvette, but Dirk Mueller in the 66 Ford and Bill Oberlin in the 25 BMW, second and third. Westbrook and Luhr complete the top five.
This is a big turnaround considering their performance levels just a week ago, and that's what the balance of performance adjustments can do. Chevy got 10 kilograms taken off their weight, Ford got 15 added. Chevy have a bit more fuel to burn today, Ford have a little bit less. Also, Chevy got some restrictor, and you can see it really turns the tables a little bit.
Well, and it's that combination that makes such, you know, it's small increments on each, but you combine them together, suddenly it becomes a significant factor.
Well, on the simulations that they did this week, Richard Westbrook didn't rest on his laurels, having won just a week ago. He's immediately in the sim on Tuesday in Charlotte, North Carolina, on the Ford simulator, and they expected it was going to be about, you know, well over half a second in terms of that adjustment of performance here at Mosport. So it's showing here in terms of the pace. They were pretty dominant at Watkins Glen. You can see here today, Corvette has slightly the upper hand right now.
You have to think, Cal, that the Porsche folks are going, okay, we're next, right?
Well, there were some comments made after qualifying yesterday, and that's a team that won here last year, and they're now literally at the back of this GTLM field, fighting hard, grinding it out. Bill Bamber said after his qualifying lap, it was maybe one of the best laps he's ever done in his life, and it didn't do much for him in terms of grid position.
Yeah, he said it was possibly one of the best qualifiers I've done, and then I looked at the time and he said there's nothing I can say about that. It is what it is. By the way, just to let you know, not missing anything in GT Daytona, Ribirez has opened up about a 4-second lead back to Andrew Davis in the number 6 Stevenson Automotive Group Audi, and Pompelli, that Spencer, in the number 16 Change Racing. Monster Energy Lamborghini another couple seconds back. So that's good action there, but it's kind of stabilized a little bit. So this battle is great. And Nunez, in no time at all, up by 3 seconds over Ricky Taylor.
Well, this is Mossport, and I'm Bruce McLaren.
Justin alluded to the amazing history that has unfolded at this track since it had its first race in 1961, Stirling Moss winning it, suggesting at the time that then turn five, which was a hairpin, should be made into two distinct apexes. It would help the racing. They did it. It did help the racing, so they named it after him. That is suitable. There is your leader in GT Daytona here at the Mobil 1 Sports Car Grand Prix. Alex Riberas, who put it on pole, has now opened up about a 5 second lead over Andrew Davis in the Audi. And you can see now a couple of the cars, players in the prototype challenge category. That's the number 8 Star Wars car of Alex Popoff coming up behind Bennett as well, as we hop on board with Andrew Davis as he exits Moss and starts this mile long bending climb up the Mario Andretti straightaway.
Yeah, Andrew Davis has done a tremendous job for this team this year. Really good qualifying run here yesterday. Currently runs in that second position. And well, the Audi, the Ferrari, and the Porsche have been running really stout this year. They all got slight increases in weight since the last round of the championship as well, but it doesn't seem to be hurting them too much right now, as it's a Porsche right front with the Riberas and Davis running in the second position. Spencer Pampulli qualified the number 16 Lamborghini for Change Racing, so a little bit of a different strategy there and kind of their lead driver during the qualifying chores. There you see him there, that bright green machine chasing after Andrew Davis.
Had a nice run in the Continental Tire race yesterday. And now sitting in third, coming after it here in that Pertamina Monster Energy car from Change Racing. By the way, the 73 of Patrick Lindsay, that is the Park Place Porsche, sits fourth. And Brett Curtis, who had an absolutely stellar run in qualifying in the 96 Turner BMWs, qualified fourth, still right there in the top five. But Andrew Davis right now is fending off Spencer Pampulli, Jamie.
Well, I talked to Andrew just before the green flag, and he said that his plan was to be aggressive at the start of this race. He said it's so difficult to pass here. He planned on putting the pressure on Riberas and hopefully forcing him into making a mistake so that he could get around. That hasn't happened so far, but I would look for some late stint moves from Andrew Davis.
Right now, Riberas has the best lap at a 118 flat, and nobody else is within 0.4 of right, that time right now. Yeah,
Andrew is the second fast lap, followed by Spencer, so they're kind of running in their order in terms of lap time potential. But Riberas is really, as we've seen so often this year, that is an incredibly stout driver lineup that Alex Job Racing has there, with Riberas and Farnbacher, Ian James assisting on the Enduros as well.
And speaking of Porsches, as we're watching Alec Riberas, Jamie, we saw the number 911 down in the pits. What was the story there?
Well, Greg, anytime you have to stop in the first 20 minutes of the race, it's certainly unplanned. Nick Tandy was on the radio with the team really struggling with those Michelin tires. The team made a softer choice on compound in qualifying yesterday, but today that's not working out for them. And the time they were losing out on the racetrack, they felt was greater than the time they would lose by making the pit stop. So they went ahead, brought him in, and did a four-tire change just to put a harder compound on that Porsche.
Yeah, I think for Porsche, they're just kind of rolling the dice in any way they can to try and find some pace. Softer compound's going to give you more grip around these long-duration corners. That can start to give up, and then when you start to get some laps under your belt, it's just going to go from worse to worse. So they tried it. They rolled the dice. It didn't work. They made the right call. Get him on some tires that are suitable and just hope that the race comes to them. But it's going to be a long day, I think, for both Porsches.
The general consensus at Canadian Tire Motorsport Park, Cal, is that it's a track that's not particularly friendly to tires, is it?
That's right. And, you know, it's going to be pretty abrasive there. It's going to be long stints here today. The GTLM on fuel can go about 60 minutes. So if you're struggling into 20 minutes in, that 40-minute mark to continue, 40 more minutes, is going to be really tough to do.
There's a look at the number 5, Christian Fittipaldi, sitting in third, but some, well, now 2 seconds or thereabouts behind Taylor. It's even a little less now as they come by and timing updates. It's that close, but boy, Nunez has just checked out to the tune of almost 11 seconds. And I think Justin wants to add about some tires here.
Yeah, I just was looking as you were talking about the tire choice there on the Porsche. Behind me here are two sets of Michelins for one of the Fords. Now, speaking with the Michelin tire engineers before the race, every one of their three compounds is being used today. And as we've just seen on the Porsche, maybe the soft one isn't working. As if they're in tandem with our thoughts, the Ford tire and the tire engineer came out and they selected that right-hand set of tires as the next one they're going to put on the car. So they're getting active data, aren't they, Calvin, from the driver, from the telemetry, and from the lap times as to what set is working perfectly, and they're making their choice on the fly. Very critical for this first pit stop. There it was in action.
It really is, and they were jockeying around with between different tire compounds, even in the last 2 hours of the 6 hours of the race, 6 hours of the Glen just 1 week ago. So it is critical. There's a real crossover point where it's going to work or it's not going to work, and you've got to be on top of that as the track temperature rises a little bit. We've got a relatively early start time here today. You would expect the track temperature to build, and then maybe you'd have to go to that harder compound if you're on softs.
And if you're smart, you've got all your own data streaming in on how your tires are working, but you're paying attention to what the other teams are doing, and you see that kind of a change, you're going to factor that in.
Oh, problem here on the front straightaway. John Pugh involved. We'd heard he already had contact with the 85 prototype challenge machine a little bit earlier in the race. Hard to tell if that's Mark Kwame involved there. Black PC machine just stranded. Not sure if he can select reverse and get out of that situation. John's got it turned around. He's got to watch this curve there.
That was nice, but that is the number, 88, the Popcorn Sutton car. Had a great run a week ago at the Glen, late pass for the podium.
Sharing that car with Richard Bradley this weekend, the Brit. He made his WeatherTech sports car debut just 1 week ago to good effect, had really good pace. Starworks are actually going to have three cars in operation at Lime Rock for the bullring that we head to next in a couple of weeks' time.
Well, looks like Kwame may have been able to get that righted and keep it green. He does.
Close call.
Yeah. Here it is.
Have a look there. John just looking to the inside. He'd already had contact with that yellow machine. Stephen Simpson, who's then behind him, just got up on the curb a little bit. And that's, again, the patience that has to be displayed in traffic. Let's watch this. John is going to have more pace through this section of the racetrack. He sees the door open, but it's a little bit too late there. That door rapidly closes there as Mark was trying to get back on power for the front straightaway.
Boy, and that number 60 car, had he been able to stay in the hunt, was one that had some speed here. The question is, did they hurt the front end of that car? We'll have to see what happens here at the Mobil 1 Sports Car Grand Prix.
Car designers on what's best for the car in question. For example, car designers want the profile of the car to remain sleek and tight, such as the gap here on the wheel arch. But for the engineers, especially for Michelin, that can cause some issues. Because remember, tires change shape under dynamic load. They're not just static like we see them here in the pit. And when they grow, which is normally in the most dangerous parts of the track, they can touch suspension parts or the wheel arch. To avoid that, Michelin issue what they call a pre-co before every event. It's a set of technical parameters that allow for the perfect dynamics of the tire with each respective car. But you know race teams, they push for that little extra edge, a little bit more camber, a little less tire pressure, sometimes just to make the driver feel better. Well, that can result in disaster because as they grow, they can rub. Now, it is a shared responsibility from the team to the engineers, to the car designers, and the drivers to ensure that a tire lasts the entire length of its stint.
As you ride on board with the 911 here, of course, that is hugely critical in terms of the simple fact that no matter how good your car is, Cal, no matter what the aero is, all the inputs are all translated to the ground by four really small contact patches. Those tires better be right.
They have to be right, and the partnerships involved in motor racing are so important. I know talking to Mike Cull with Ganassi Racing when they started to work with Michelin with this Ford GT program coming online, he was just amazed at their ability and their information and stuff that they had to share with the group, and it's worked out really well. Obviously this car, the 911 car, tough day. As we said, they had to hit pit lane, do that tire change, so they're trying to rebound here a little bit. So we're now on board here with Dirk Mueller, continues to run in that second position. You can see that yellow Corvette up ahead. That's Garcia, just over a second down the road. Mueller got a little bit of traffic there, so that gap may have increased a little bit. Now Orbelin tries to fight through the same traffic.
And he couldn't get it done. Wanted to get through on Lindsay, still not able to get through. So he's going to lose a little bit of time. He was almost within a second, finally, of Mueller. And I think that's going to go away now. Now he's got to come on. The problem is, Cal, these GT3 cars in a straight line, they're pretty stout compared to the GT Le Mans cars.
They really are. And this is what four classes of race is all about, because you're looking forward, you're looking behind. That PC car was coming through. Nunez continuing to do a great job as he threads his way through traffic. Look at this. It's like rush hour traffic there on that Mario Andretti straightaway.
Oh, that is such fun to watch, and always a joy to watch these Corvettes perform. And you know, there's a guy who's so connected with the history of Corvette, he also is now very connected to this track. Justin?
Well, I feel like I'm with a cross between Bernie Eccleston and Jackie Stewart, and anyway, the Canadian version. I was your teammate back in 2000 with the factory team, but what a journey you have been on in the preceding, or following, decade and a half. Ron Fellows, this is your track and really your brand.
Thank you. Well, you know, we've obviously had a lot of help. I've got a great partner with Carlo Fidani, and we've got a number of great partners commercially. You know, Canadian Tire Corp has been a fantastic addition. Great marketing support, and you know, obviously, this is the Mobil 1 Sports Car Grand Prix this weekend. So we're thrilled things are going well. We've taken an iconic track, bucket list track for drivers, kept the layout the same, but have improved the infrastructure a ton. And that was the goal, to try to get it, you know, get an iconic track into the 21st century in terms of corporate hospitality, viewing improvements, and just, you know, general connectivity. So it's been really neat. You know, this is the track I grew up learning how to race on, and I know I don't live that far, you know, on the other side of Toronto. So it means a lot, and you know, to have Carlo Fidani take such a great interest in the sport and in this facility has been fantastic for racing in general.
And now let's talk all things Corvette. Corvette, what a great fitting thing, really, that they're running at the front of the field right now. Your role as an ambassador for Corvette, explain that. What is the sort of job spec there?
Yeah, well, you know, I get it. When you're driving, it's you don't get to spend a lot of time in the Corvette corral talking with the owners. So I have a lot more time to spend with the Corvette owners and with you know, public in general, because you're you know, we're one of the originals, and yeah, just having the opportunity to be able to continue to promote the Corvette brand and talk racing, you know. And this is an atmosphere where, you know, you're not completely focused on driving. You're, you know, here having a good time and being continuing to be part of the Corvette race program.
Well, thanks, Ron. I know he's taking a close look on what the gate was when people came in, but now he's worried about how the team were. And I must say, Ron, I don't know if Calvin can hear it, but you sound more Canadian north of the border, just saying.
Oh, thanks, eh?
Very cool.
Oh, absolute class act. When you take a look at his accomplishments over the years, Cal, in everything he's touched, certainly. And I mean, you know, he was hugely successful in Trans Am before Corvette Racing came along. And you mean, just look at some of these numbers here. You know, his Le Mans wins, etc. And he, you know, NASCAR successes as well. Everything he drives superbly.
Such a great competitor, a great racer, but to put a bow or a bow tie on this, I mean, he's just exactly. A great guy. I mean, pure and simple, everyone loves Ron Fellows.
Well, you know, when a manufacturer, the year after you officially retire, actually puts out a special edition Corvette with your name on it, tells you in what high regard they have for Ron Fellows, a special gentleman in every sense of the word here. And look at a couple of moments here down in the always tricky Moss Corner, Cal.
Oh, look at that. Fisichella looks, you know, saying that today. Fisichella looks to the inside of the Porsche. There was contact there, as you could see. It's tough racing. Bamber's got around the 62, so Fisichella was trying to get that position back in amongst traffic in Moss Corner. And that's our leader, overall leader, Nunez, right behind them.
Boy, Fisichella has been uber aggressive early in the race here, hasn't it? So as we go back now to our live cut there, you see second place overall, Ricky Taylor, the black Konica Minolta, Wayne Taylor Racing entry, and look right behind him now. Points leaders.
And we talked about it, Greg, in terms of it being a three-horse race between the 5, the 10, and the 31. First of all, they have to beat the 5, and the 5 is putting the pressure on. Christian Fittipaldi doing an amazing job here on the opening stint, as he continues to do. Two-time champs, along with Joao Barbosa. Action Express proving very hard to beat once again.
And unfortunately, while we were in break, we saw a stop by the 100 BMW. Jamie, what are you hearing?
Well, it's a bad day for the 100 guys, Greg. They brought the car to pit lane, Lucas did, and it turns out he lost power steering, so that car's actually back in the paddock with the team right now. Their plan is to get him back out here so they can get some of those championship points, but it's not going to be a podium or a race win today.
That's a shame. They showed some awfully good form in qualifying. Lucas Lewis seemed to have some pretty good speed here. Cal, last year we saw huge power steering issues through a variety of the classes, but it was a good 20 degrees warmer. But still, the long loads in these corners, man, it just stacks up this power steering, doesn't it?
It really does. And the teams like Mike Shank Racing, remember Oz Negri had huge issues. He had his drink bottle fail. He had power steering fail. Mike Shank had to literally talk him through the last hour of that race, just try and keep him motivated, keep him focused, because he was really overheated in more ways than one. They put cooling systems on those power steering pumps now, on the ECU units that run those electronic power steering units. And they've changed the geometry of the steering arms and stuff to try and ease that load, because if they start to fail the power steering systems around this racetrack, it's almost like the steering locks up and you can't turn the car to keep it on the racetrack.
Yeah, diabolical when it happens, no question about that. We are on board with your leader, Tristan Nunez, 15 plus seconds up the road. Simpson leads in prototype challenge. Garcia and Riberas hold station in the two GT classes. We come back riding on board second place in GT Daytona, Andrew Davis in the number 6 Stevenson Automotive Group Audi. Well, we've had some interesting things unfolding while we're in break. Great racing and great action like that, slicing through. And we're getting a report now that the number 70 is in pit lane, and they're looking. Our leader, Nunez, might be making a call to the pits in short order as well, Cal, but he has blossomed this up to over 23 seconds lead.
Well, I think what they may be doing is giving the priority to the lead car, the 55 right now. They don't want to stack up in pit lane, so get Tom Long in, send him on his way. About 45 minutes is the kind of the range I've been here, and obviously you got the pace laps to deal with on this opening stint as well. So it wouldn't surprise me to maybe see Nunez in shortly as well, just get that first pit stop out of the way, clear the way, get everyone regrouped here.
Prior to long stop, if you take Nunez out of the picture, that second through basically six, really close.
It was really close, basically spread by about 5 seconds. So Nunez is gone, but the rest of the field is really tight between Taylor, Fittipaldi, Long, Goossens, Eric Curran. It was a fascinating battle that was developing through traffic.
On board now with the number 22, Cooper McNeil, the WeatherTech Porsche from Alex Job Racing.
These guys started from pit lane, had a fuel leak this morning, so couldn't make the pre-grid time, so they're in catch-up mode.
And we're hearing that the Corvettes are making their way down to the pits. JB?
Yeah, Oliver Gavin just brought in the number 4. Tommy Milner jumping in. Very strategic, I'm sure, for them to come in right now. The pit lane is nice and empty. Of course, this end of the pit lane is very steep. It's quite an incline as you make your way down. So coming off the blocks will be important, not to exceed the speed limit on the way out. Nice clean start, Jamie.
Well, the number 55 has been brought to pit lane. Tristan Nunez now out of the car. Jonathan Bomarito getting behind the wheel. They do have a jack out, though, to lift up the front end of this car. Sylvain Tremblay from Speed Source is down here. I asked him if there was a problem. He said potentially it looked like maybe the air jack in the car, that air jack system wasn't working properly. So they had to jack up the car to do this tire change, which of course is just one extra step. It's one thing you don't want to have to do under race conditions. They have to go back up. That rear tire did not get put on. So this team losing valuable time here in the pit box. The air jack not working, guys.
The The number three just pulled up into its box. Obviously, Josson of the lap after the number four. Magnussen getting in the car. Critical stop this, because right in front of them are two of the Daytona prototype lined up. Nice exit of the pit lane, and I can see the number five is making a scheduled stop right at the front of this field as the leader goes by.
Look at that delay for the leader. Nunez was about 15 seconds down the road, and there you could see Christian Fittipaldi, who was running third. He almost beat him out, and there's Dane Cameron looking for a move on Joao Barbosa, I believe, is taking over the... Look at this, they try to make a sandwich. Oh, that was really aggressive there by Dane Cameron looking to the inside.
He's
the two teammates going hard at it.
Around the outside, Cameron staying put, Cal. He's done it.
Yes, it is Barbosa now behind the wheel. And that was the delta, that was the loss for the Mazda group by having that air jack problem. Cost them about 15 to 20 seconds.
Oh boy, and now Bomarito has huge work to do as the 10 is in. Justin.
Ricky out, Jordan in, coming in. Of course, their pit lane is clear right now. Let's not underestimate the importance of having a stop in the pits. There you have the minimum amount of distraction and fuss. The tires are going on, they're waiting on the fuel. They will obviously have to take a full fuel stop at this stage of the, and it's gone, a nice clear. As he pulls out and goes out, that is a very good stop for the number 10.
Look at this, Dane Cameron, he had to get a good outlap here. Can he beat Ricky Taylor as he whistles now through turn one? I think he may just get him. It's gonna be close.
What?
There he goes. The 90 car should be hitting the pits, either this lap or the next, and Taylor runs wide. He doesn't have the tire temp as he tries to defend there from Joao Barbosa.
Wow, that was a great stop. No question of that. Wayne Taylor Racing always doing that. The 97 BMW, Michael Marsal, having a problem. That's in the turn eight area. And that's up over that rise. And it looks like he may have just pulled off there, Cal.
Well, they got to be careful. The 90 car that leads right now, they're rolling the dice by running him completely out of fuel. Now they're in. Because if it goes yellow, pit lane would be closed. You would really be hurt by that strategy. So they've just got Goosens in quickly enough. I assume it's DL now going to take over the driving chores as the GTLM field start to come in as well. That's Dirk Mueller now in. Joey Hand going behind the wheel. Justin.
Yeah, it looks a bit complicated here. Look at the angle of the 67, Calvin. They had to come in across the nose of his sister car. Driver changes. This is, you know, however many times you plan, as Richard Westbrook climbs out, you never quite can make contingency for the fact that your teammate will be in front of you and you're offset as you come in. 66, that was a beautiful stop. Doors closing on the 67. Driver securely in, cleaning the windshield. It's all, this is good stuff as they head out. They're putting a bit of Bondo tape on the left-hand mirror, Calvin. Let's keep an eye on that. The left-hand driver's side mirror has special tape on it holding it in place.
I believe there was conversation between the 66 and the 67 at Watkins Glen on one of these pit stops. That left rear keeps getting left in the way. You could see Joey Hand could barely get around that exiting his pit box, so the groups have got to work together. There's one thing if it's a rival, but when it's your team car and you're leaving tires in pit lane right in the path that he needs to take.
There's the Ricci car out, as is Fisichella. Wielander now on board, and Averland climbs out. That's the number 25. Watch that stop. They came in from an awfully successful run, led as they came in. Dirk Werner on board. And your points leader in prototype challenge is in. You can see that. The number 8 of Papa is in, turning over to Renger van de Zande.
54 on pit lane. They grabbed the pole yesterday with Colin Brown, but made a change of strategy overnight. Changed the driver lineup back to John Bennett. They had to go to the back of the field. Werner was sensational last week at the Glen as he and his teammate took a podium run.
Very strong podium run. Second, actually, starting the second of the last lap. It was that close. Here we go, number 67. Now Ryan Briscoe at the helm, going for their third consecutive win in WeatherTech Championship competition. And as we take a look at some of the players in the GT Daytona category, there's your points leader, the 63 of Christina Nielsen, still down the order just a bit.
For many years, the idea of simulation took hours and hours and hours to build a model, insert it into an environment, and test it.
This tool allows us to use tire models, chassis models, and laser scanned racetrack models to put our car through real-time testing, ultimately make changes on the car, and before we even show up at the racetrack, determine optimal chassis setups to try to gain a competitive advantage on our competition.
Yeah, the DIL simulator is amazingly accurate, down to the feel of the steering, to the throttle and brake response. You can literally take your brake points and your cornering speeds and your gearing, and it will apply directly to the race car. We've actually been able to take some of our drivers, specifically this year before Sebring, and help them with developing their skills at Sebring before actually coming to the 12 hours.
We've used the driver in the loop simulator to go to a racetrack in the simulation room before we show up at the racetrack. 9 times out of 10, the simulator data and what we get out of the simulator ultimately is what we roll off the truck with in terms of our first setup. And quite often our engineers attempt to better what the simulator is telling them, and 9 times out of 10, the simulator is accurate.
Well, you heard John Doonan refer to tire modeling, and of course these cars all run on the Continental Tire, and that's a huge part of that modeling program.
It really is, and it's such a valuable tool and resource to have there at Multimatic to work through the best setups when you come to a race circuit for the drivers to get in the driver in the loop, as they call it. Is great practice, essentially, simulation of the racetrack, but so much information can be gained and time saved in terms of practice days and setup days in terms of identifying what is the optimum setup. This battle is really intense there. You see the 90 car of DL has got around the 10 machine, as the 50 car, 55 car very much in recovery mode here, haven't had that snafu on the pit lane.
Yeah, remember had that 23-second lead starting the pit stop. Ooh, way wide by Taylor.
Wow, talk about that in the gray.
Gathered it back up, but wow.
As in the old days, that wouldn't have been. That runoff rim has been added.
That was a big hit in the old days. But Bomarito now 7 seconds behind and sitting in fifth, as you talked about the recovery. And this is why they are now in such recovery mode after showing such stunning pace. We heard Jamie give the call. They have a problem with the air jack, Cal.
Yeah, the air jack didn't seem to be getting the car high enough off the ground, possibly. And then they're working on the right rear corner. So I assumed it was front tires are going to be the problem. It's actually the right rear that was the issue and cost them valuable time. I think it was about 15 seconds was the ultimate time loss compared, because Nunez had a healthy lead. We talked about him having clear sailing and then that battle for second, but suddenly that all changed. And then we saw the intensity of the Action Express teammates. Dan Cameron told me last night they were going to put it all on the line. They're going to get very aggressive with strategy. And one thing I've seen right now, Dan Cameron just set fastest lap of the race at a 1:10.4, 3 tenths quicker than the 55 car set earlier in this race. So maybe they've got aggressive with their tire pressures as well. Yeah. High starting pressure gets them alive a little bit sooner, but he put it all on the line there, grabbing the lead essentially with that move around Joao Barbosa and the 55 car as they exited pit lane.
He's uncorked a couple other 1:10s as well. Everybody else, I mean, Barbosa just got down into the low 111s at a 111 flat, but nobody's touching Cameron. And then, of course, what happened at pit out, Cal, in that pit sequence?
There it is, just on the hot tires. And then you can see Jordan Taylor doesn't have the tire temp there to defend from Joao Barbosa either.
And there is Barbosa now, as he now sits in that second spot, but almost 4 seconds back of Cameron onto the front straight one more time. That time Cameron, I think, bottled up in some traffic, turned to 111.8, and Barbosa 111 flat again, and he's making some time. But then right there at the exit of one, Barbosa just has to pause a little bit for that 27 Dream Racing Lamborghini.
Well, you've got to have that patience. We said that's one of the keys to victory. Dan Cameron didn't show any patience in trying to get that track position early. But right now, he's got 3 to 4 second buffer that he's working with. But look at this. It is really wild around this racetrack because even though those GTLM cars have tremendous downforce and grip through the corners, the prototypes are simply much faster, but you can't run over the top of them. As you can see there, the Delta back to his teammate Joao Barbosa is close rapidly there as Dane lost a lot of ground through Moss.
Yeah, he's trimming it big time right now. Now what he's got to hope is that Barbosa gets held up by that same group of cars that he had to work his way through, and oftentimes that's exactly what happens, and you get that accordion effect.
Well, right here, now Dane's going to get through these final couple of corners clean before he hits traffic again. Joao Barbosa is right in the middle of it as he goes through turn nine.
Oh boy, look at that, a 12.9 by Dane that time.
Two and a half seconds slower than his fastest lap of the race. That's how much time you can lose in traffic. Look at this, Barbosa now behind the 63 machine.
And he turned to 13.1, so he definitely got caught up in that traffic. Even more costly for him at this point. Exiting turn two, and you've got Ryan Dial now caught up in that scrum as well. But of course, for the Taylors, they had a great stop. Looked like they came out in time, but the temps just weren't quite there. What was Ricky saying about that opening stint?
Well, Ricky, we're talking about you got out in front and you were able to stay there by the skinny skin of your teeth. But that was a close first start for you. What do you think? You jumped it or was it just good timing?
Well, I mean, I was staying next to him and I think he tried to get me to break and then he was going to go. I didn't want to play games and back up the whole field. And I went when Bo said to go, so that's all I can do. They didn't call off the start. And I'd probably be complaining if I was them. But, you know, I didn't want to break and go all the way back to fifth or sixth.
But it was beautiful racing from there on. Amazing action for everyone watching at home. I think Calvin and Greg almost lost an aorta. I mean, some of the moves you guys were having to do was extraordinary. It is fun racing around here, right?
It's a lot of work. It's a lot of fun, too. I mean, I'm watching the race over your shoulder, and you just can't take your eyes off of it for a second. But really struggling that first stint on the qualifying tires. I knew having Tristan behind me was only a temporary buffer. He was going to get by and run away. But I think, you know, our ConocoMinolta guys are going to give us a good strategy here and see what the man Jordan Taylor can do to the end.
Of course, these guys are blinding in the pits. What's happening down your end, Jamie?
Well, for the Mazda mid-race report, Tristan Nunez is now out of the car following that last pit stop. It's the second pole of the season for Tristan and for Mazda, but still looking for that elusive first win. Tristan, talk me through the start of this race. You guys said it looked like a jump start. Race control said no call. What was it like from your seat?
I don't know. From the car, it seemed like a jump start, but I can't see from what they're seeing outside. But I trust race control. They seems like they can make a good decision. So it is what it is. I was able to get the lead back through traffic just using the GT cars as picks. So, you know, our Mazda prototype is good, you know, through traffic and all that. So, you know, the guys are fast out there. So it was tough to be able to capitalize on that. So it's fun racing out there. It really is.
And you drove a great stint. You got back around to the race lead. But then the problem in the pit stop, it looked like it was an anticipated failure of the airjack system. How aware of that were you guys coming into the race?
It was a small little issue that we found before we rolled off to the recon laps this morning. But we just wanted to be sure. So we brought the extra equipment out there. And when the airjack wasn't working correctly, we capitalized on it. So that's just, you know, being heads up. Great job by the Mazda crew by, you know, keeping their heads up and capitalizing on those unfortunates. But, you know, we're doing what we can. Just got to see how the race plays out and see what happens in the next pit stop. But keeping our fingers crossed right now.
All right. Thank you, Tristan.
Yeah, I'll tell you, I mean, you have to react like that, but they still struggled with that one corner, the right rear. And we're watching here the 85 of Steven Simpson as he has built up now an almost 50-second lead over the second car, the number 38 for Performance Tech of James French. So the JDC Miller Motorsports car, two wins already this year, and looking strong here at the Mobil 1 Sports Car Grand Prix at Canadian Tire Motorsport Park. Stay with us. Welcome back. You ride on board with Jonathan Bomarito, fifth overall and in prototype, but 16 seconds back of race leader Dane Cameron in the 31 Whelen Engineering Team Fox Corvette DP. Great to have you with us. If you're just joining us, Greg Creamer, Calvin Fish in the booth. And Justin Bell, Jamie Howe joining us on pit lane. And this is a car, no question about it, Cal, remarkable speed here. But the team, just when everything goes right, something seems to always go wrong.
Yeah, it's such a shame because the car's had tremendous pace at a number of events this year, and they had a good run going once again. And that pit lane incident just got them in trouble here. And now in traffic, certainly the P2 can't get around the traffic quite as easily as a DP machine like Dane Cameron.
Just saw Dane swerving a little bit, working his way from three down to four. Maybe going offline to pass another car. Maybe dirty those tires up a little bit.
I would imagine that's what's going on. Otherwise, he's trying to feel out an issue, but I'd say you're correct there, Greg. But the move that he made was so aggressive. He told me last night we need to get aggressive in strategy and everything else, and this is exiting the pits. Everyone on relatively cold tires, of course. And look at that. He goes to the inside, almost gets into the side of the 55, but watch here. Barbosa probably thinks, oh, I'm okay now. I've got the inside line. And Dane just realizes that he's got to somehow try and make a move. They've got to do something. We talked about it at the top of the show, Greg. You've got to beat the five. Otherwise, you're going to run out of races.
And he was able to make that pass stick around the outside of turn three. And to do that, you have to have big bravado.
Yes, it's putting on the line, but that's what it's coming down
yeah,
to. You
exactly.
said four races to go, time's running out. If the five cars to beat the 31 here today, and it's not over by a long stretch, looking at the clock, obviously an hour and a half to go, but if the five car would beat the 31, you're further behind. You're gonna be at least 10 points behind, and that's tough to make up.
And now what? Oh, that was
22 really
well
wide there
the
in
way.
Moss. Save Dane losing
mirrors.
Any time, but that's the gap now. Remember, just a few laps ago, it was 2 to 3 seconds.
Now 11 plus.
Yeah, it's huge.
And what Dane needs is for Ryan Dial in that number 90 Visit Florida car to find it a little bit, get up there and sneak around.
Well, his dad engineers the 90, so it's like, come on, Dad, tune that thing up and get Dial in front of Barbosa. But this is a fierce battle between the Chevy teams here for the overall honors this year. Yes, the P2 cars from Shank and from Mazda certainly showing tremendous pace. But in terms of the championship, it's going to come down to these bow tie teams. And it is pretty much a three-horse race. But the 90 car, they're going to keep digging deep. They realize they've dug a big hole with the problems at Detroit and at Watkins Glen. But they're having a strong run here today with DL behind the wheel.
Sitting in third, they're going to be liking that. Taylor fourth, and then Bomarito in the 55 in fifth.
Look
still
at this.
Magnussen leading.
25 is closing in. Werner is
close.
On a charge, Greg. He laid down a lap, a clear half second clear of the rest of the GTLM field. A 1:15.4. Unbelievable with everyone else running in the 16 range, but traffic is hurting him a little bit on this lap.
Well, that's a lap time that everybody fifth and back in GTLM qualifying would have loved to have in the qualifying session.
It's tremendous. I mean, BMW felt they've got a good chance here. They didn't get adjustment in terms of the balance of performance since the last round of the championship. And I really felt they'd be tough here today. But right now, it's all about track position, and Jan Magnussen has it for Corvette Racing.
And traffic. In this image, there are all four of the classes that are racing here out that windshield of the 25 car. That's what makes this series so special. And then you do it at this track. It is absolutely huge.
Look at that. It's Sir Dirk Werner compared to Magnussen. Tell you what, Corvette Racing has such a record here. I know it's Ron Fellow's track, but it almost seems unfair how many victories they've had.
Yeah, huge number of wins here. And, I mean, Fellow's had a number. Magnussen has a huge number of wins here. Six total,
right.
Five in Corvettes.
He loves this place.
Yep.
Jan loves to put it on the line. And this is a fun racetrack, Greg. It is total commitment. This turn two is simply amazing. You plunge over that hill. It's like you're falling out of a window, yet the car's accelerating.
And now with that huge paved runoff, you don't get the visual of just how intimidating and breathtaking that corner is, but it remains it to drive.
It is. Driving it is the same, but from a sheer visual, we keep beating Ronnie Fellows up every time we see him. Like, we got to put a little curbing on the outside, or a grass verge, or paint it, or something, because it's like looking at an awesome golf hole in the winter when the grass is dormant. You don't see that ribbon effect of the layout of the hole, and you don't see the layout of turn two any longer with that massive runoff area.
Well, it's a corner that really put, I think, the old Mosport on the global map in terms of being a world-class racetrack in terms of challenge. And it'd be nice to see it again. They have that grass verge in eight, and it really does show still just how fierce that corner is as we ride on board with the pole-sitting car now in the hands of Jan Magnussen.
Probably Jordan Taylor would disagree. He liked that runoff area there
really
a little bit
earlier. Jan having a very busy year, racing in his home championship as well in Denmark, and he said, we've got a lead. He said, I think it's the next weekend. They've got a street race through downtown Copenhagen. He said, I need to really get a big win there because I got to miss a round, I think, at VIR.
That's right.
And he said, I got to pad the lead a little bit to have a shot at it here. And he's doing what he needs to do here. Justin Bell, the lead now, 2.3 seconds back to Werner.
Well, you know, you talk about Corvette and their winning history here, and I think that's a very big factor in play. I was talking with Doug Feehan yesterday, and he said, obviously, we are happy with the BOP gain that we've had. He said, but don't take our advantage here as quite as literally as it looks, as good as it looks. We have a database, a depth of knowledge about this racetrack that no other team has got. We also have the advantage of having Ron Fellows on our advisory squad. He said, our drivers know it. He said, so we're quicker, perhaps, than we really are would be at other tracks with our BOP. Of course, they're making full advantage of that. And obviously, in the end, it's all about getting a win. But Calvin, I think the knowledge factor and the experience goes a long way, don't you?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I think for Ford, BMW, and Ferrari, they've all got brand new race cars this year. But I think certainly for Ford, they come here, they didn't test up here, whereas they did at Watkins Glen, for example. So they are very strong last weekend. So they're learning through the course of the weekend. We had sessions that were interrupted with rain, so you didn't get a full course of dry running. So there's a lot of work to get done. And even with simulators and such, there's nothing like putting those four Michelin tires on the ground and seeing how the car performs.
And if you don't get track time like you talked about, having that data book is huge. 17 years Corvette Racing has been coming to this track. In those 17 years, 11 wins. Yeah, that's a pretty huge data book. In your upper left, there are your four class leaders. We'll be right back. Welcome back, everybody, and we are under full course caution here at Canadian Tire Motorsport Park. Our first one of the day, and it happened just after we went to our last break, the number 55. That was the car that had such a great run early but had that problem in the pits. Listen to this, Cal, as he comes out of turn 10.
We got a problem, no drive. Feels like something in the transmission, axle, something broke. Actually, it's the right rear tire. I can see it moving.
Just try to pull off somewhere if you can. I don't know if he could get it back for this.
That's tough there. He got to the outside. He really needed to be.
I have no drive. I'm just coasting. Just coasting. No forward.
If you could be careful, bring it back up to you. Let us know. All right.
I have no drive. There's no way I could get it back. Nothing pushing me forward, just spinning up in the RPM.
Yeah, all right. Yeah, I think something broke on the axle. Looks like the wheel is kind of janky.
Hub, because I can see the right rear tire moved out to the right.
All right, and of course, under this caution, pit stops have come and gone, unfortunately, in our DP category, in our prototype category. And let's get a little bit of an update from Justin Bell. What unfolded?
Well, you can imagine they came in to the pit stop right now, the 31 leading. Fantastic. I had to pull around the front. They did a very nice stop. I believe it was left tires only on the 31, but I will have to clarify that. And right behind me was the 10. They came in very nicely. I think the one of the cars from up Jamie's end had an even better pit stop. I don't know who that was, Jamie. Maybe you know. But I saw one of the DPs come by, literally taking the lead in the pit lane.
It was the number 70 Mazda, Justin. They came in. It was fuel and four new Continentals as the team had the, you know, the disappointed looks on their face still after that 55 had to bring out this full course caution.
Well, and that's when a team really gets tested, doesn't it? You have that one car that has had such success, then had the problem in that first pit stop, then pulls off, and then you've got another car that you got to step up and get the job done on, and they did it. But it certainly looked to me, Cal, we have to wait till timing and scoring cycles, like the number 90 car had a tremendous stop.
They really did, so I'm not sure what sort of strategy they pulled there. I mean, there's not a lot you can do in terms of short fields. You pretty much need two full fuel loads to get to the finish here with the amount of time on the clock. You could maybe, you know, trim a couple of seconds out. They'd have been stacked up. I mean, Dane Cameron had about 11, 12-second lead. That would have been a raise sitting behind the safety car, so they'd all come in together. We didn't quite see it, of course. And so you could maybe trim a couple of seconds and jump ahead. So, again, rolling the dice. Maybe they did that to get the track position. Yep. We said risk, position, you know, keys to victory. They may have just short-filled it by a couple of seconds, banking on a yellow, getting them back in their window to get to the finish.
Meanwhile, into the pits comes your leader in the GT Daytona category, Mario Farnbacher. And the number 48 of Madison Snow came in as well in that Paul Miller Racing. Castrol, that is the Lamborghini, and they did a little out-of-sequence early stop, and Madison ended up doing a stint and a half and did a very nice job, Cal.
Trouble is now he's going to have more fuel going on board, so that may cost him a little bit. Brian Sellers has been really quick in this car this weekend, just working on getting the setup right. Conversely, Madison Snow didn't get quite as much seat time as he typically likes, so that was why they qualified a bit further back. What are you seeing, Jamie?
It was a whole slew of GTD pit stops. The number 9 Stevenson car as well as the 96 BMW came in. So a lot of strategy being played right now. It was a great pit stop for the number 48. But as you mentioned, they did pit from the second position but did need to take on more fuel than that race leading number 23. Problem though now for the number 9 car, fuel and tires both complete. They have the door open. So long pit stop for Stevenson.
Oh, that's unfortunate. They were showing some pretty good pace. And now that's going to change up just a little bit. And it's going to be interesting to see how the GT Daytona stops all cycle out here. But let's look at the end of the prototype pit stops, Cal, where we can see just how well-placed things went. Watch the bottom of the screen here. There he is.
There goes the 90. He beats them out easily. See Dane Cameron having to flick around the outside of Barboza. He'd have hit the pit stall before the 5 car. So everyone else looked like they kind of did the same as each other, but the 90 car, big advantage there. Maybe they trimmed that refueling a little bit, rolling the dice. We'll have to wait and see.
Well, there's the 55 on the flatbed coming around. We're going to take a quick break here at the Mobil 1 Sports Car Grand Prix, but we'll be right back. We are back to green here at Canadian Tire Motorsport Park for the Mobil 1 Sports Car Grand Prix. And as you can see, picked up the leader in the GT Le Mans category for the lead. But here is one of the battles that we are looking for. And look at Dane Cameron just going over the top, falling down into turn two, attacking on Ryan Dial.
Yeah, and Taylor's doing the same on Barboza. But again, he's out in the gray there, exiting turn two. This is wild stuff. Everyone putting it all on the line as the overall leader is now trying to make their mark.
Working their way through the top three in GT Le Mans, going around Joey Hand in third, now attacking on Werner in second in the BMW, both getting through.
Cameron there thinks better of it. He can't afford to tuck it to the inside. Now he gets around Dirk Werner and chases after DL. Great restart for Ryan DL, and he's escaped the traffic now. Now he can just put clear laps together. Battle for third is intensifying though. That black machine, the Conor Minolta machine. Here comes Jordan Taylor. Looks to the inside.
He got a run and he does the outside
move.
Gets the 5 and sweeps around the 25. What a move by Jordan.
That was perfection. Just read the traffic perfectly. He had the outside lane. And here comes Barboza now trying to recover a little bit. And we talked about the day that you needed. You got to beat the 5, then you got to try and gap them in the points as well. And that is seeing reality at this moment.
Well, certainly, as Johnny O'Connell would say, that group that's chasing that 5-car, Cal, for the rest of the year has to be racing on the sword.
And it's a double-edged sword, and I thought it could have got really hairy there between the prototype cars and the GT Le Mans cars. So they did a nice job there of clearing those nicely. Fastest lap today, Cameron's got 0.6 seconds over DL. DL only took 2 tires. That's how they got that lead. They only took 2 tires versus 4.
By the way, you see the number 60, a stop and hold for 2 minutes, 22 seconds for an improper pass around. So what they do is they hold you for the lap that you gained and then a lap of a penalty. That's a big one, and that's going to cost them dearly. Problems early when Pugh had the incident coming out of turn 10, and now Faraz, it's gone bad to worse. But this is compelling stuff now. Free air at the front, Cal. Dial and Cameron.
Dial, left side tires only on that last pit stop. Cameron, I believe, took four. Great dynamic here. Dane's dad engineers the 90 car, so he's on the pit box, rooting on his car, obviously, the car he works on, but it's his son right behind him.
What a run down through two. Here is the exit of three. Tricky, but let's go back. Just take a look at some of this fierce racing, Cal.
There you see Ryan Dial slices it to the inside of a little touch there on the right front fender. I thought it was going to open up the door for Dane Cameron. He thinks better of it. He has to wait. Joey Hand there right in the mix as well, sitting in the third position in the Ford GT.
The chess match, that high speed, that is multi-class sports car racing, so compelling.
Cameron's closer.
Yeah, he is. Half a second almost. Last time by, far less than that. There's Jordan Taylor now.
Seems like he's got the bit between his teeth a little bit. The 10 car has come alive here. Defending race champions. Beautiful flow through those final couple of corners. Then the roller coaster ride begins.
Yep, down to well under half a second now. First to second, Dial to Cameron. Taylor, another 2 seconds back. But in a short time, Cal, he's opened up a second and a half on Barbosa.
Yeah, Barbosa's car hasn't come alive just yet. We'll have to wait and see if that changes over the course of the long green flag run. Again, we've got to wait and see what that two-tire versus four-tire does over this green flag run as well for Ryan Dial.
Moss, such a tricky piece of real estate and hugely important to a lap here.
It really is. You've got to have good exit speed. You can't afford to slide the car off of that corner. You need a good, clean exit. That will then affect your terminal speed up this long Mario Andretti straightaway. 90 car looks like it stretches a little bit there. Maybe he's running a little bit less downforce. Cameron may have to wait for an opportunity in traffic.
Now, they had talked about at Watkins Glen, Cal, I remember you talking about that they found what the issue was that they were having, and they said, now we can actually really start to work on getting a fast setup on the car, and apparently they have. Ooh, opportunity for Cameron in traffic, though.
Backs it off, I think Dial. Oh, this is for the lead in GTLM. Werner all over the back of Magnussen. Joey Hand in the wings as well.
Werner has been showing some superb pace.
Tommy Milner close to this lead trio as well. Corvettes run first and fourth right now. BMWs and Ford in between them.
Boy, top three there covered by the proverbial blanket.
Werner is a man very much on form these days, doing a great job. Closes in on Magnussen a little bit through turn three. And the torque of that Corvette should be in good shape here as he accelerates away.
Flowing down into Moss one more time. The GT Le Mans battle. Top two separated by nothing. Carl Haas was a young racer that made the sport not only his life, but his livelihood. After being a fierce competitor of Paul Newman's as team owners in the second iteration of Can-Am, the two formed an IndyCar team when Mario Andretti said he'd like to drive for them. It then turned into a juggernaut, and with drivers like Mario, his son Michael, Nigel Mansell, Cristiano D'Amata, and Sebastian Bourdais, they won 8 Champ Car titles. And with the help of others, including Christian Fittipaldi, they scored a remarkable 107 IndyCar wins over the team's 28 years. And the list of stars that drove for Carl in a variety of series over the years is truly a who's who of racing's finest. It was announced earlier this week that Carl, at 86, had passed away. He, with his trademark cigar, became an icon, a Hall of Famer, a legend. He will be deeply missed, but always remembered, and our thoughts are with his family and friends. Canadian Tire Motorsport Park has held more Can-Am races in its history by far than any other track. It was, for many years, the heart and soul of Can-Am. We've had a lot of drivers say that they compare this track. Look at that, the tire coming off of the 23, and that's the car second in the points, and that was while we were in break. The car has made its way into pit lane. At first, Cal, it looked like it was just a flat tire, and then it just departed the car completely.
Yeah, it did, and the mechanics down there on that left front corner saying there's some kind of issue. I think they may have had to pit for emergency service with a short, we call a short yellow, where the pits remain closed, so they may have to serve another penalty here. JB, what are you seeing?
Well, they're going to work on the back end of the front left caliper. You can see there, they're pulling it off. The mechanic saw something wrong, so they were literally putting the new tire back on, the new Continental, just at one on the front left, because obviously that's the one that came off. But now, as you can see, the quick release has taken off that caliper. Pretty hot old stuff in there. As he's looking behind, he's looking at the rotor. I'll give you an update a little bit later, guys, on what's going on here when they sort it. But this does have serious point implications for this championship.
It has strategy implications for the GTD leading number 73 from Park Place with Jörg Bergmeister behind the wheel. The team was up on the wall ready for a pit stop to fulfill their fuel strategy for this race. But when this caution came out, pits remained closed. And now what has to happen, because it is a short yellow, and the pits will stay closed until after the green. So Jörg will have to take the green flag out on the racetrack before making that stop for fuel. The effect right now, though, is he's had to switch to fuel saving mode to take that green flag. Then they can make their scheduled stop.
Yeah, I think he's got a few more laps. I don't think he's out, Jamie, but certainly it was not ideal in terms of their strategy. So we'll have to wait and see what they do, if they go back to green and try and see if he can gap the field a little bit. He last pitted on lap 40, and he's got 28 laps on this stint.
Well, he's the guy you want to have behind the wheel, too. Porsche made a note here that in the top GT class, so GT Le Mans here, since 1999, they've got 8 GT wins, and 4 of them, Jörg Bergmeister was one of the drivers. So the man knows how to deal with scenarios here. And speaking of Porsches, Justin, I believe you have Cooper McNeil from the 22 car.
Yeah, I do. The thing is with these young drivers, they don't look exhausted like we do, Calvin. We're just doing the TV. Cooper, obviously a bit of a problem here for the sister car of 23. What are they saying is actually happening?
First they had a flat, and then I think the flat knocked something loose, and then the wheel came off. I'm not really entirely sure.
Okay, but obviously the 22, solid out there, solid run. You love this track, you were telling me earlier, but it is difficult to race on, isn't it?
Yeah, it's very difficult. High pace, very fast corners, high consequence, so you really have to place the car perfectly, especially with all the other cars doing 160, 70, 80 miles an hour around you trying to pass you. But it's really fast. Our WeatherTech Porsche is doing really well, and Lee's out there doing a great job.
And of course, you said it, that the top speeds in these Porsches, in these GTD cars, is actually exceptional, and the prototypes don't go that much faster, do they? I think we're actually not far off going green on the next lap, Cooper, so you go back to the bots, watch what's gonna happen. Guys?
You are correct, Justin, as the pace car in, and Ryan Dial leads them to the stripe and the green flag back to racing here. Cameron Taylor Barbosa, and then a car that is the 60, but remember now, down a couple of laps due to that infraction and long hold for the penalty.
Good battle in PC as well. Steven Simpson continues to lead. Tom Kimbersmith just a couple of car lengths behind him. Head down into turn three. There you see that bright yellow machine. That's the leader in PC.
They had built up a huge lead in that category, of course, negated by the two full course cautions. And this has been a breakthrough year for that number 85 Miller JDC team. As we zoom in on Jordan Taylor, got a reset opportunity here to see if he can stay a little closer to the 31 and the leading number 90.
I think on this stint, that number 10 car definitely seems to have a little bit more pace. I'm not sure if they made a tire pressure adjustment or Jordan just made some adjustments inside the cockpit, but he seems to have speed right now, and he may have something for the two leaders here today.
Joel Miller now on board the number 70 as we just dip underneath the hour to go mark. And Joel Miller in that number 70 sits in fifth. And of course, the big deficit they had has been erased. Let's see whether they're able to do anything here. But wow, what a battle we have unfolding in GT Le Mans. This is the stuff this class is famous for.
Yeah, this is crazy. And there's a bit of a split strategy going on because the 67 of Briscoe, McAvecky, and the Porsche and Wielander, they all pitted under that, not this last yellow because it was a close pit. situation, but the yellow before that, so they've got a lot more fuel on board. Everyone will need one more pit stop to get to the finish. However, some of the cars will be on pit lane a lot longer, topping their tanks up. Jamie?
Well, the GTD leader, number 73, Jörg Bergmeister, did make his way to pit lane. It is a full service stop. Jörg will stay behind the wheel of the car. Fuel for new Continentals. They're not brand new, though. They're not stickers. It's a scrub set. They had it marked as set three, so they've been on the car previously this weekend. We'll come up to temperature a little bit faster. It was a nice, clean pit stop for Park Place.
And it's actually worked out okay for them, Jamie, because everyone's going to need one more stop in GTD to get to the finish. I mean, they're not going to need as lengthy a pit stop, but I mean, Jörg was essentially almost at maybe had 10 laps of fuel left. The others may be a bit quicker on pit lane itself, but here we see that battle for the lead in GT. TLM Magnussen holding the middle of the road. Then he goes to the inside as Werner looks for a way by.
That 25 BMW has some serious pace here, Cal. They're just not able to quite get it done there. But Werner is just going to hound at this stage.
Did someone die for the pit lane?
Look like it.
Maybe Joey Hand. The other Corvette comes with him. So they're inside their fuel window. They look at the clock. 58 minutes on the board. That's just inside their fuel window of 60 minutes today. So this should be their final pit stop. Top him up with fuel and see if the race will come to you. JB.
Yeah, the 66 obviously pulled to the stand just in front of him, about 100 feet down for it, closer to the number four car that came in. I'm seeing full left-hand tires only going on at the moment. Are they going to the... No, all four tires on the Corvette. I'm looking back up in the pit lane. All four tires going on the 66. This is a race off pit lane. And believe you and me, Calvin, as they leave downhill from this stand at the end, the 66 is already underway. We've got the 63 Ferrari about to mix it up as well. It is a racing line exiting the pits here. This is just bloody brilliant.
Well, we talk about the Ford versus Corvette battle. It happened on pit lane right there. Tommy Milner, an old BMW teammate of Joey Hand, beats him out.
Well, that Corvette racing, they are known for stellar pit stops. It's certainly played out there. And that Ferrari in the mix, the points leader in GT Daytona, Alessandro Balzan, came in from the sixth spot. As we watch now, your leader in GT Le Mans, Mags, into the pit lane.
Well, the dominoes start to fall. You have to follow suit. If you're leading this race, you can't afford to stay out there because the next yellow would be a full procedure. Pit lanes would be closed initially, but then you'd have to come and you'd lose all of your track position.
And as the number three comes in, we're on board the 911. Justin, what's happening for the three?
Well, that seemed like a smart call, didn't it, to you guys? Because the pit lane is now open as Garcia is getting into the car and Magnussen is out. So all four new Michelins going on. Car's looking mighty fine right now. The 911 is just pulling past. The pit lane is empty and clear, and that is a pretty good way to do a pit stop as it pulls out.
Before the car was off the jacks, the IMSA officials heard it as well, so I look for a penalty for the Porsche. We're waiting on the GTD leading number six.
And Cal, I've got to think that that initial move by the car sitting in third and fourth in GT Le Mans into the pits, that goes back to one of our keys to victory, position. They were playing the position game
Werner
at the end of the race, yes?
So we say there's that domino effect.
Yep.
It'll all be about, did Werner have a clean lap? He had a fast race car. Did he lay down? Was it hammer time for Dirk Werner to try and gain a little bit in terms of his hot lap, in terms of having hot tires versus a cold out lap for Garcia? We'll have to see how this plays out. With that tire temperature, he should have been able to lay down a really quick lap. Garcia's going to be out there scrambling for grip as those Michelins come up to temperature.
It's all down to how quick they execute this four tire change they're obviously going for, and fuel down.
It was a short stop for the six car from Stevenson. Robin Liddell stayed in the car to take it to the checkers. Left side Continental only and fuel to the finish.
And the interesting thing here is, where did Werner exit? Oh, he's clear by a bunch, it looks like, Cal. No, check that.
Yeah, so the yellow
is
a BMW, not
the
Corvettes. We've got to wait and see how things shuffle here. It's going to be tight.
Meanwhile, that 911, you saw that stop. You heard the wheel spin. Race control has said drive-through penalty.
Cameron has got around Ryan Biel for the overall lead of this race. These guys can't pit yet, and if it stayed green, get to the finish. Let's take a look at how this happened in traffic. Down into turn three, big stack up there. Dane slices it to the inside. I think Ryan was just waiting to see how that pack would develop. Dane Cameron putting all on the line here today. He knows that it's time. He's got to get a victory there first of the year.
Boy, and then Dial got just squeezed a little bit by Vilander. I don't think he realized he was there. And that parked him a little more. Cameron able to slice through, and he has picked up the lead. We're going to take a quick pause. When we come back, we'll look at how everything is sorted out from the pit stops. Coming up on 50 minutes remaining here in the Mobil 1 Sports Car Grand Prix at Canadian Tire Motorsport Park. And we've got some serious action unfolding here. Cameron continues to lead over Dial, Taylor, Barbosa, and Miller in GT Le Mans. The 67 of Briscoe, McAvecky, Milner, Werner, and Garcia. So Ford, Porsche, Chevy, BMW, and Chevy is pretty good. And in GT Daytona, things have come absolutely upside down. The 27 Change Racing, Dream Racing Lamborghini in the hands of factory Lamborghini driver Fabio Babini leads it. But they're due a stop. Blika Molin in the 33 Viper Cal has brought that car up into the lead.
Well, GTD didn't run here last year. They did in 2014.
And guess who
the
won?
Viper won. Blika Molin and Keating. Keating loves this racetrack. Did a nice job in qualifying yesterday. Girona is one of the fastest GT drivers in the world. So they've got a good man at the reins of this Viper right now.
Interesting story for them. When they won here in 2014, it was the first for them as a driver pairing. It was the first for Viper in IMSA competition. So as you said, a very special place for them. But right now, Jamie, they are chasing the number 27. It's had a snake bit year, but they're on form here.
Yeah, you mentioned they're still going to need a pit stop, so they're going to lose that race lead. But just to see them up there fighting for the lead of this race is pretty impressive. When you consider that last week at Watkins Glen, they did not make the start of the race. They had to bring out the spare car that they've had since the beginning of the season. You're not allowed to do that under a race weekend competition. So they went ahead, got that car built up. This is effectively a brand new car that they rode for the first time on Friday here at Canadian Tire Motorsports Park. So to see it have that much speed when it's still getting broken in, it's pretty impressive stuff.
It is, and I mean, yeah, you're right. It was a huge shunt Larry DeGeorge had at the Glen, and he isn't here this weekend. Apparently, he had some business commitments, I think, and Cedric Spiriswally, who's the starting driver in that team, very, very quick, and Babini, we know, is good. So yeah, just good for them to get some track time, be able to show what they can do. And looking here at the number four, of Tommy Milner.
He's been a man on the move. Hey. He's up to third position right now, and he's chasing after Ryan Briscoe and Freddie McAvecky. They're on a different pit stop strategy. Right now, Milner is 38 seconds behind the lead of the pit lane delta here. He's just under 26 seconds. So if Briscoe needs less than 12 seconds of fuel, he should maintain the lead. So this is going to be fascinating to see how this one plays out. But the four car ahead of the three, brilliant run by Milner.
And in the course of our break, just to keep you in the loop here in Prototype Challenge, Ringer van de Zande went from fourth to second and is within 1.2 seconds of that bright yellow machine of Steven Simpson. And there you can see one car back behind that Corvette is Ringer, and he is absolutely flying right now. And coming up with Tom Kimber-Smith behind him in the 52 in third. But there is that number four Corvette. What a stop, but the 90 is in. Jamie?
And the battle for the race lead now brought to pit lane. Ryan Giel will stay behind the wheel of the number 90 from Visit Florida Racing. They're going to take four new Continental tires, not left side only. So four new tires to do battle with out there. The team was impressive in morning warm-up. They posted the fastest time, but that was after they made the decision to go back to their setup from Watkins Glen. They started back at ground zero. It's worked out for them. We'll see what they can do in the closing stages.
Really a great effort, Jamie, by that whole group there. They took two tires on the last stop. They had to go with four. Now we're looking at our leader, Dane Cameron. He may be able to take two. Remember, he took four on this previous stop. I don't think he's quite in the fuel window yet. I think 45 minutes would be the mark where they'd be safe to stay full rich and get to the finish. Can't afford to roll the dice too much longer, so I'm sure once they're in the window, they will come.
Now, here's a look at, watch the left here, Cal. This is how Milner got by Werner.
Traffic there. Prototype comes around at the outside. Milner follows him through. That is a brave move around the outside of turn eight. That is putting it all on the line.
That's where you need to have huge trust in the guy that you're making that move on.
You need huge something.
Good point. There is a look at the leader, Briscoe.
To call him.
Exactly.
Briscoe, he's going to be digging deep. Ford going for four victories in a row, including the win at Le Mans, but it would be possibly three consecutive victories in this IMSA WeatherTech Championship for Ryan Briscoe and Richard Westbrook, who celebrates his birthday today. He's just got to keep pushing, keep pushing. If he can increase that gap, he may be able to get on pit lane and get out and beat Tommy Milner. He's really in a battle for the victory for today.
He's up almost 12 seconds on Mekovecki in the 912 Porsche in second, and up 17 right now in the number four, Milner.
Well, I don't think that's enough.
Yep.
He has lost a lot of ground to...
Ooh, Werner just held up a little bit by that 27, and that has now allowed Garcia to get a big run.
Yeah, Milner has closed incredibly. Let's get back to the battle for the prototype win. JB, the 31's on pit lane.
Yeah, you caught it, Calvin. It is left side tires only. The fuel are waiting on this. The seconds are ticking by because the 10 is ready to pounce, and they lead the pit lane. Jamie, I think you're seeing them coming down the pit lane soon.
Tell you what, I saw a tap on the shoulder like a short fill. I mean, he pretty much needed a full fuel load, so hopefully they got enough fuel in that 31 car.
Well, they wanted enough in, but not one drop more in terms of time saving. I was a little surprised to see that, as you said, with the tap.
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty much a full fuel load needed to get to the finish. If we stay green, you may have been able to cut it by a second or two, but not much more. We'll have to wait and see. I think this is just how tough the game is right now. And remember, it's one team car against the other. They're trying to beat the five as the 10 car now hits pit lane. Jordan Taylor has been sensational in this stint. Really got that car alive. Here comes Barbosa. Everyone has to come. You can't afford to stay out there and get caught out with the yellow.
And it is the points scenario unfolding as well. Jamie?
Well, Rick, Jordan Taylor has brought the car in. He's perfectly on his marks, but it does look a little tight to get that right rear tire on. Did take rear tires. I did not see.
So a left rear for sure. Jamie could not see the right side of the car to know if they took a right rear corner as well, but definitely no front tires on the 10.
And the number five out as well. Weren't able to get out in front of the number 10.
Left side only on the five, the championship leader.
It's an interesting strategy for
well,
the
this is Harry right
yeah.
now for Ooh. Taylor.
Yep.
He's got to be careful. He can't turn the wheel normally with the normal steering, but he's got hot front tires, relatively cold rears.
Yep. He needs to be careful until those tires all come up to temp. So work cut out for Jordan Taylor. We'll see how it all plays out when we come back. Visit racetowincorvette.com and enter for your chance to win every sports car lover's dream. A 2016 Corvette Stingray Coupe, a trip to the 2017 Rolex 24 Daytona, and a Paul Reed Smith IMSA Collector's Edition guitar. To do it, all you have to do is text, visit racetowincorvette.com. It could all be yours. Welcome back, everybody. GT Le Mans category, that's your pole setting car, the number three. And that car is back in the order a little bit, and
in position.
Yeah.
Just to get back to Briscoe. He actually ducked into the pit lane. Our timing and scoring out of the cycle, we said, well, he didn't have enough lead to maintain the gap, to maintain the lead. He'd already ducked in, so great strategy called there by Chip Ganassi Racing. Once again, Briscoe was out. He took fuel only, no tires. Maintains the lead by 11 seconds over Freddie Mekovecki in the Porsche.
And the other question is, number three, we're seeing it's Garcia in the car. So on the last stop, apparently, Cal, they did the driver change as well.
They did. I think JB was on that when he hit pit lane.
But there is Briscoe Last time by, the margin was up over 11 seconds in hand over Makovecki, who stopped on lap 76.
This all gets back to when they took fuel a little bit earlier under that caution when the leaders stayed out. The 67 car that did not have great track position, they topped him up, and that basically got them on the right side, the way the yellows have played out, to get this strategy going. It's going to be a long stint on his tires. I think that's probably the biggest concern, is maintaining the pace with the tires. The Al there, who runs in the fourth position now behind Cameron Taylor and Barbosa, trying to find a way by.
They lost some serious time with that four-tire stop. He's some 8 seconds back of Barbosa. However, assuming it stays green, you can see that car maybe pick up some speed relative to the others. But boy, that play for the 31 Whelan Team Fox Corvette DP Cal, that was absolutely superb execution for them. That margin now 7.5 seconds clear of the number 10 Konica Minolta Corvette DP of Jordan Taylor.
Don't count out Jordan Taylor, though. He's just ran a lap of 110.6 just a few laps ago. So he has got tremendous pace. That's just a couple of tenths off of Dane Cameron's fastest lap of the day of a 10.4. And he's only 7 seconds plus back. So if Dane should hit traffic, Jordan's going to be right there.
Well, and you know that car is hooking up coming out of Moss with those two new rears.
What a run for this team.
I was just going to say that.
That big balance of a performance adjustment. They had 15 kilos added. They lost some boost, lost a little bit of fuel. But today, I don't think they've done it on sheer speed, because Vern has been mighty in that BMW. He ran a lap of a 15.4. Fastest lap by Briscoe today is a 15.9. So he's about half a second slower than that number 25 BMW we're looking at right there. But in terms of strategy, it has definitely come the 67's way as they go for a three in a row.
And the number 70 Mazda getting in between our battle for the final podium spot, held currently by the number 4 of Tommy Milner. And right behind him is Werner. He talked about the speed that that number 25 BMW has had all day today, and Werner has been doing a great job. And Garcia, though, coming up, he's not too far adrift of Werner. So it's soon to be a three-car battle for third as we ride on board with Joel Miller. Another coulda, woulda, shoulda day for the Mazda prototype team.
Yeah, it's almost to a heartbreak situation because they've shown tremendous pace. They're doing everything right, and then the race comes at them and little things are going wrong. So I'm sure they'll regroup again. It's a great group led by Sylvain Tremblay and the Speed Source operation. Got a lot of talent on that group. They've got a lot of heart too, led by John Doonan from Mazda Motorsports. They got tremendous driver lineup, so their day will come. I thought today was going to be the day.
Yeah, I mean,
Nunez was flying, and that pit stop kind of got them behind the eight ball. And the P2 cars, if they don't have clear track, certainly struggle a bit more compared to the Daytona prototypes.
Well, sort of their slogan is never stop challenging, and they've certainly got their challenges, but they continue to pursue it here as we're watching. Fun little battle here as well. Up to the front, there is Babini still hanging on. And that number 9 car, that's Lawson Aschenbach, who's down a bit as Taylor comes through, working through on them. And then your battle for what is second at this point, Blika Mullen and Jens Klingman in the 96 Turner BMW. Klingman, factory BMW driver. This is going to be a great battle and will eventually be for the lead when Babini has to stop, Cal.
Yeah, this is the virtual race in terms of when that Lamborghini hits pit road. This will be for the win here today. They should both be within their fuel window to get to the finish. Great job by Brett Curtis, Klingman's teammate, who did a great job in qualifying, kept it up at the sharp end throughout the course of the race. And Jens Klingman is one of the top drivers in Europe. BMW factory driver loaned to Turner Motorsports for this year. That's a strong driver pairing.
You know, we often talk about, and you look at the two classes, you know, GT Le Mans, that's the class with all the buzz and the like. But GT Daytona, you look at, especially for the second drivers in some of these cars, world-class stuff.
Oh, it's awesome. You look at Blika Mullen, Klingman, Liddell, Balzahn, Brian Sellers, Bergmeister, Lally, Pompelli, Aschenbach, Lee Keen. I mean, the list goes on.
Riding on board here, that big V10. In the front end of that Viper, going for two in a row here. Even though they didn't run last year, they won it in 2014. And we are closing in on our final 30 minutes, so don't go anywhere. Welcome back, everybody. We want to remind you about a key couple of major sports car events coming up. First of all, next round of the IMSA WeatherTech Sports Car Championship, Saturday, July 3rd, 23rd, excuse me. And we're stepping it up. It is going to be live on Fox. So make sure you don't miss it, 3 p.m. Eastern time. And that same weekend, the next day, the 24th, you will be able to watch the first round of the World Endurance Championship since the 24 Hours of Le Mans, FS1. You're home for that right here, 7 a.m. Eastern time. Busy weekend for one C. Fish.
It's going to be fun, mate. Got the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge that weekend as well from Lime Rock. And it's going to be the Bullring. No prototypes running there, just three classes, PC, GTLM, GTD at Lime Rock. And then can Toyota rebound from that disappointment at Le Mans at the next round of the WEC at Nürburgring? Going to be fascinating.
It doesn't really matter who you're cheering for in the LMP1 category right now. I think everybody's got a very soft spot for Toyota after what happened. And, boy, watching this great battle unfolding here, and this is going to be for the lead, even though Babini hasn't pitted yet. Bleekemolen and Klingman, such is the pace of their battle, it has taken them right onto the back, the number nine, down a lap of Aschenbach, trying to get that lap back. And now Klingman down to the inside of Bleekemolen a couple of laps ago.
He's going to clear the Lamborghini, which will put him in front of the Viper. That could
be move.
Basically for the win here today. What a move by Klingman.
And Cal, they were grinding on, problems. Look at that. Something off of the front end of the Viper spray. Coming up onto the windshield, it looked like. Yeah, you can see it, Cal.
Yeah. Sure, if that's a fender rub or what's going on, there's definitely something misting a little bit there.
Now, there may have been a touch or two. They were.
Yeah, that may be from the, is that from the rad area?
That's
up over the hood?
Yeah, wrinkle on that front end. And a lap before that, they were grinding on each other. Klingman rubbing on the back of the Viper. Exit of turn two, and he's in.
He's in, yeah. He's got an issue. Wow. Can you believe it, Jamie? Viper's heading your way. I believe they may have a radiator or some kind of issue with that race car.
Well, the team was quick to react after that contact, Calvin. They got their gloves and their helmets on quickly. Bill Riley on the radio saying water temp pressure dropping, hit this lap. He brought it in. There's heavy damage on the front of this Viper. And talking to him right before the start of this race, Jerome was saying how aggressive you have to be here when they're at a deficit in straight line speed and horsepower. Right now, the race not going their way. It was going to be at least a podium.
Now, this was all unfolded in the battle for the lead of that class. So a huge moment here, and it was just fierce racing.
Well, so intense here, as we said. Oh, that's a bit of blow. They had a great run going here today. Ben Keating, Jerome Bleekemolen. Right now is the Turner Motorsports BMW out front. Babini continues to run in second spot. Sellers is having a great run here.
Now let's go back and see what may have happened here. As we're watching on the left there, you can see the problems during the pit stop, but we think we found that. And interesting to see here. Here you go, Cal.
Coming down through turn four. Klingman goes to the outside. There it is. There's the bump. He hits Babini, and that does the damage. And immediately on the telemetry, Bill Riley and the team could tell there's a water pressure issue. Gets stacked up there. Babini's on relatively old tires. He doesn't quite have the pace any longer. He's also going to need fuel, we believe, to get to the finish.
And right as Jerome went to the throttle coming out of five, we saw that spray from the onboard. And that was it. And like I said, a couple of laps before that, Klingman coming out of turn two, thought he had a run. Jerome covered it just a little bit. They touched a couple of times. Let's get back down to Jamie.
The team still at work on the 3-3. It's quite a mess down here, guys. The water continues to come out of this Viper machine. Riley's on the radio, though, telling his guys that you need to stay calm. We need to get this work done quickly. They're replacing the radiator on the Viper. Their goal is to get out of pit lane and stay ahead of the 23 car for championship points.
That's a very good point. The 23 car down a number of laps, so that opportunity certainly is still there. And now with Balzan up into fourth as a result of that incident, and they had stopped, they jumped in with that first group of GT Le Mans car. Balzan followed him right in, Cal, playing that position game, and now sits in fourth. But we had that camera shot at the back of the 33. You can see a little wrinkle in the rear bodywork. That was from that touch from Klingman. Just before this big incident unfolded. Boy, huge swing here.
Yeah, Paul Miller Racing having a great day as well. We talk about their strategy. Madison Snow did a nice job, but Brian Sellers has been on fire right now. He's up to the third position, got around the Ferrari. It was Klingman, Liddell, Sellers, Balzan, Bergmeister, Lally, the top six in GTD.
Klingman just throwing the number 96 IHG Rewards Club BMW around.
Lap time sensational, yeah. 17.5, fastest lap in GTD. A couple of other guys in the high 17 range, but the majority of the field running mid to low 18s.
Well, we talked a little bit about how good that platform should be here. I mean, they were third. The team was third here in 2014 with Paltala and Dane Cameron in the Z4. So you knew this new car should be even stronger here with that longer wheelbase. Let's get back down to Jamie.
Well, Earl Bamber started this race eighth on the GTLM grid, but big smile on your face right now. You guys looking for your fourth podium of the season. What's been the biggest factor in getting through the field today?
I mean, the biggest factor has been the guys behind us. I mean, they did a fantastic strategy and awesome pit work. That's really what's brought us to the front. You can see the others caught us, and now we have to try hold on for second or the podium for the last 20 minutes. So, I mean, Fred's really flat out on the car, and I think he'll do a great job to the end.
I love it when a driver guy says that it all comes down to the pit crew. It certainly has for them today.
Well, sometimes we forget it's a team sport, and that plays out. But during that interview, the number four of Milner snuck underneath, coming
never
out
fails,
of turn 10, and made the pass on Makovecki, so they now sit in third. Now let's check in with Justin on the number 31.
Well, Eric's Curran, obviously watching very attentively of how the 31 Whelan Corvette's going out there. Sonny Whelan said to me this morning, he said, you know, we should be on TV a bit more. And I said, well, if you lead, if you win, you know, you're going to get a lot of TV time. And here we are. In the car, Dane is being extraordinary right now, and the car must be working well.
Yeah, car's working unbelievable. I mean, I'm fortunate because I got one of the best co-drivers out there, and I got one of the best sponsors and one of the best teams at Action Express. So, I mean, Dane's out there leading. Had a bit of a battle early on in the race and traffic, man. Trying to get through traffic is a challenge. So Dane's doing a great job, though. And I got hats off to these guys, their pit stops. They're nailing those pit stops one after another. So, you know, this whole crew, Wheel and Engineering, you know, we finished second here last year. And it's time to get back up on the top step. We're second in the championship. This would be good for us in the big scope. So I also want to say happy 10th birthday to Haley at home. So, you know, it's a good day. It's going to be a long 25 minutes to go, but I feel good about it. So we're ready. It's time for us to win again.
As he said, it's time for him to win again, and we may have a new Scott Pruitt taking over in the Hello to Everyone at Home states.
Well, and he referred to it again, too, the crew. This is such a team sport. Yeah, the drivers, I've said it before, get the accolades, but these crews, they often work the magic in providing them not just fast but safe race cars. And they certainly have today for the number 31. And Dane Cameron now, the lead up to almost 7.5 seconds clear of the number 10 of Jordan Taylor. Joao Barbosa, your point leader, still lurking right there in third. Welcome back, everybody. You ride on board with the number 912 of Fred Makovecki as he sits in third spot, chasing Tommy Milner and Briscoe. Time for our Porsche news and notes. And Cal, big stories here. A couple manufacturers maybe going to be on board for 2017, one of them possibly in two classes.
That's right. Mercedes looking at a potential entry in the DPI class, the top class next year. They've got a GT3 car already built, and they're looking at attracting teams for that for next year. So that would be great news on both fronts. Acura GT3 car, well, is already testing now on U.S. soil. They had a European team do the initial development. They're now on U.S. soil, and it's exciting to think that they could be on the track racing in this championship next year as well.
What a couple of great ads it would be. And of course, a team that is doing incredibly well right now in GT Daytona. Your class leader, the number 96, Klingman leads for Will Turner, and Jamie's with Will.
Well, Turner Motorsports has yet to win a race this season. They did finish second on the podium at the 12 hours of Sebring, but they've been developing the car all season. But Will, you guys took the lead of this race with some bad luck from the number 33 machine. When you have a day like this, what does it do to recharge this organization?
Well, a couple things. It's not over yet. And you know, in IMSA racing, especially this racing, anything can happen right up to the last minute. You know, the team's worked hard since we've got these cars back in December. And a win would obviously add momentum for the season. It's been great. The motivation of the team, the fans of this M6, the fans, just the BMW fans in general, have been behind us. We've constantly developed the car since Daytona. Daytona to Sebring were some major developments. Since Sebring, it's just been some minor tweaks. Unfortunately, the other car went out with some transmission issues, which is really the first mechanical that we've had on this car all season, which is a testament to how good BMW did in planning these cars and building these cars, so I hope that carries through. So, you know, out there now, Jens made a great move for the lead, and I hope we can continue. We are really, really going to be close on fuel. So right now it's a little iffy, I'm a little nervous, but hopefully we can get a win, the first win for the BMW M6 GT3.
Fingers crossed, toes crossed, everything anticipating the checkers, guys.
Well, and you know what, Cal, you know, Will is a great team owner, but they got one of the best strategists on the box in Don Salama. Think back to Lime Rock a couple years ago. They know fuel.
They really do, and they're on the same strategy as guys like Bergmeister and Lally in terms of when they last pitted, but I think it was right at the hour mark or just shy off, so they should be good. I'm sure they're telling Jens what the fuel numbers are, some numbers to hit, some targets to reach, but what they did at Lime Rock with Dane Cameron and Michael Marcel when they won here and shocked everyone by running, I think, about an hour 20 or something, hour 25 on a full fuel load. It's amazing what fuel save you can get, particularly at a racetrack like this, because you can go through that coast phase through the corner, roll out of the power, and it's not so much just RPM usage throughout the range in terms of the gears. It's more about coming completely off the gas pedal. I'm sure Jens Klingman has done some training to get that worked out as well.
You know what? It's not just GT Daytona teams that may be paying extra close attention to fuel, Justin.
Well, it certainly isn't. Do you remember, Calvin, we saw the 67 come in out of sequence for fueled only, no tires, quite a while back. Well, Corvette certainly are watching closely, because either they, as Corvette said, it's a stroke of genius, a great race call, or if you watch the lap times of the 67, which is definitely off the pace a little right now, are they going to run out of the fuel? You're the master of this, Calvin. How long have they got left? How much fuel do we think they have? But definitely the pace has dropped off. So sometimes you roll the dice, isn't that the phrase? And sometimes it works in your favor, but certainly there's a little tension here in the Ford pits.
Well, the big question mark is, Justin, we don't know how much fuel they put on board. He certainly hit a lap number where if they topped him off, he'd have been well within range, but they short-filled him to try and maintain track position. Did they cut it too close? We certainly know that they worked on things like that even at the Daytona 24-hour race. We saw Westbrook win on fuel mileage at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca, and he said, basically, we weren't in a position where we were just running laps. We then went out and learned how to run the same lap time and save fuel at the same moment. So maybe Briscoe's been through the same training. He's an ex-IndyCar driver where you have to do that on occasions. I'm sure he's on top of things. Brad Goldberg, the engineer, will be talking him through it.
He just saw the number 912, and McElvecchi running way wide, exiting turn two, and that has allowed Garcia through. Dirk Werner is coming after him as well. Well, here's a look at the Ricci pit. When we come back, we'll take you all the way to the checkered flag here at the Mobil 1 Sports Car Grand Prix. That should be all the evidence you need about why they call Lime Rock Park the Bullring and why you don't want to miss that race. And it was that close. Now, we had a bit of a moment right before we came back here, and it was between the number 66 Ford GT of Joey Hand and this car, the 100 of John Edwards, down a number of laps, and here's what happened, Cal.
Well, it's down into Moss here. You can see Joey Hand right behind John Edwards, and I think he was just getting totally frustrated. John has tremendous pace here today, but he's many laps down with that power steering issue, and Joey is in the thick of a battle there. He's running in the sixth position, but really close to Garcia, Werner, and McElvecchi, and he just couldn't get to them because John didn't want to let him by, even though he's many laps down. So I think Joey said, enough's enough, you're going for a ride. See how the stewards look at it.
And they are reviewing it. We just got word. But as you said, you know, he was going after McElvecchi, but then Werner and McElvecchi, I think, was going to be the easy get. And Werner's been showing some good speed. So maybe some team play coming in here. And
the stewards may look into the big picture as well.
Right,
they could have seen that, you know, if John was a few laps down, and maybe they're thinking, well, maybe he should make it a little bit easy. But they're all racing hard. They all want to try and get the best result for their team and the manufacturer.
What's the thing? Race how you want to be raced. Oh, Cameron
to the outside. Joey wants by that BMW, so you got the leader.
There's Makovecki.
Joey slides to the inside. He's got to try and chase down that Porsche. He's a lot closer to those guys before that moment with Edwards. Cameron's lead is up over 14 seconds right now. Jordan Taylor continues to run in third. But it's tight between Taylor and Barbosa. They're within a couple of seconds here. Remember the critical part of this championship in terms of that point spread. We talked about it at the beginning of the day. Cameron and Eric Curran have done everything they can, but they need that spread. They need that buffer in points. Jordan Taylor is giving them that right now. But if Barbosa should get around, it'd only be a three-point swing tonight.
Interestingly, too, Dial at one point, Cal, had closed up to within 4 seconds of Barbosa, and now that has ballooned to 13 seconds, and he's running very quick lap time, so he must have had some moment on the track.
Yeah, really quick. He ran a 1:10.5 a few laps ago.
Cameron knifes underneath Dirk Werner. That margin now up to over 14 seconds.
There's this battle. Ooh. Look at that. That's the 5 and the 10. How close they were. They just got separated, though.
Ooh.
Oh, Jordan Taylor off and on. Putting it all on the line.
Now, the problem is you need to be careful because in that dirt on the exit of those curbs, the outside of those curbs, there's a bit of oil. Mm-hmm. And you get that on those tires, and that would have been the tires into turn one. Apparently, he felt okay with it.
As tight as this championship is right now, with only 3 rounds remaining after the checkered flag here today, every position is critical. That's why these boys are digging so deep right now. They recognize it can be a 4-point swing here. You can be game 2 on the 5 car, or you can lose 2. That is massive with only 3 rounds to go after this race.
Well, this is interesting here because you had 2 completely different strategies in terms of tires during the last stop on these 2 cars, Cal. Rears for the rears only for the number 10. And I think lefts for the number 5. So which one works out? By the way, just got word, no call by race control on the 66-100 tink.
Yep. So a racing incident, as they call it. There's a lot backstory to that, but we'll discuss that another day.
Started at the Glen.
It did, yeah. I think there was some closeness between those 2 cars in the early laps of the Glen as well, in terms of the 100 and the 66 and the GT Land battle. But look at Barbosa. I wonder if Jordan Taylor, by not taking front tires, is getting some understeer in that car right now. He's struggling for pace. Barbosa has it.
Big moment by Barbosa, though. He got the curb on the inside, and it completely loosened that car. It was a mega save.
That really was. And the drivers love that extra runoff room there. Because if you're into the grass at that critical phase, loaded phase of the corner, you'd be going for a ride.
Boy, immediately though, Taylor gets stacked up behind the Ricci number 62. And the 96, leader in GTD.
That was close. They were 3 wide there, right through that critical little apex. It's flat out, of course. But look at this run that Barbosa's got. The points were given right now, which they are not, with 6 minutes on the board, and the 5 car wants a lot more. This is potentially what we'd be looking at the end of the day.
Yeah, 2 points. And if they run now, you can see it, a 2-point margin between Fittipaldi Barbosa in the 5 and the number 31, the team cars.
Fittipaldi and Barbosa came in with a 7-point lead over the, both Cameron and Curran, and Taylor and Taylor are all tied on the
here
same
it
player.
Is.
It is, yeah. I think Jordan Taylor may have just run out of front tires, and now he's locking them up. Yeah, he's just struggling. We just got confirmation from the pit box that he is struggling for understeer. So that gamble, we talked about it in terms of track position. They did that to try and gain some track position. They needed rears, obviously. Maybe had some issues with traction here today. Needed rear tires. Didn't take front to save time, but it's cost them in the late going.
Yeah, he just cannot get it to turn, and it won't stick on the exits. And even with that big wiggle by the number 5 of Fittipaldi, the next time through, too, he's got a tremendous run.
Action Express coming off a 1-2 run at Watkins Glen just a week ago. And with this move, potentially repeating that feat. You can see there, Jordan just gets really wide, and he's not on power either, because you can see the way that Barbosa just accelerated by him. He takes it in really deep there, locks it up a little bit. Maybe game over in terms of a battle for this second position.
Ooh, problem here. Sean Rahal now behind the wheel of the Zero Delta Wing. Into the tires. It's a matter of where it is, what kind of runoff there is, as we are at, coming up on 4 minutes remaining. That is the entrance of three, essentially.
Gonna be a big call here.
Oh,
there's not really enough time to clear it. Oh, and he's. That's the good news for everyone in the race itself.
He could just.
Oh, look at Taylor, really wide. He's got to make sure he doesn't cord one of those tires. Been a long, long stint for those front tires.
Oh, and that's the number 44, Lally. GT Daytona. Yeah, Andy Lally in the Magnus Racing
turn
car
one.
Off of turn one, Cal.
Wonder if someone tried to go down the inside of him and spared him. It's a strange angle to go in at. See the tire marks very early in the corner. Wonder if there's a little bump as he's trying to get it turned in. These guys are coming off a strong run at Watkins Glen. This was earlier. This is Bergmeister and Lally going hard at it.
Wow.
And this is not where he's at right now. This is turn three. He's now in turn one. Did he cut a tire or something in that moment? And that caused him the problem in turn one.
Now this is, we got another look at it in.
Yeah, I wonder if he cut down a tire in that moment with Bergmeister. Or something broke. There's a pretty hefty bump there in turn three. Two guys going at it hard.
Yep.
There's a battle at the time for the sixth position.
And they're third in the points. That's the RX Solar Magnus Racing Audi. That is going to change things up in the GTD points battle. As I said, they came in third. They were 8 points off of the 23, which is laps down. Balzon sits fourth in the Scuderia car. That's your point leader coming in.
Yeah, it's going to be good news for them because the 23 car, that their closest competitor, having a bad day, losing that wheel in the early going.
Then the number 33 was the car that was fourth in the points. They are back out. A great repair by the crew, but they're down 6 laps. Meanwhile, almost 21 seconds now, Carl.
He realized it was go time. They needed a victory. They needed maximum points to get back in this chase. They've been hanging in there. They had the lead a couple of rounds ago and then lost it at Detroit when they got involved with a 90s incident. Cost them dearly because they were super fast that day. But right now, this could seal the deal. We go full course caution with just a lap to go.
Yeah, no way.
He's to slow it down a bit, then he'll get the white. Looking at the clock.
Maybe that's exactly what he's trying to do here.
Huh?
Smart move.
Yeah, the team's saying. Either way, you don't have to have the white to get the checkered on the clock. And congratulations there. There's Don Salama in the middle of the pit box. That's Brett Curtis. What a job he did today.
What a run in qualifying he did. Fourth.
Amazing.
Against the group, a number of the pro guns were in qualifying, and he put it fourth. White flag is out. So the 31 overall in prototype in GT Le Mans, the number 67 Ford, third straight for that team.
Colin Brown in PC. Simpson eventually pitted, eventually got out of the car, and the advantage they have is two silvers in that car, because I was looking at the minimum drive time for PC, and Simpson did the majority of the running today, but when they're both silvers, they can have either one do the minimum drive time of 60 minutes for PC today. Colin Brown, what a rebound after the problems they had at Watkins Glen, switching to a spare chassis, starting at the back of the field, haven't changed their driver lineup, starting driver, should I say, after the qualifying. There's a great moment there between Christian Fittipaldi and Eric Curran. There's Simon, the engineer.
By the way, for Dane, that is going to be his 8th IMSA WeatherTech win. That's pretty amazing set of stats when you consider what this championship is. That's going to put him alone in the win column.
Got a lot with those boys to get that number.
Absolutely, he did.
Right for Turner Motorsports with GTD Championship in 2014.
Came in tied with Bennett and Colin Brown. Now he will stand alone.
Turner Motorsports team on the wall. Clay Filson from BMW on the left side of the screen. He's a great man to have in your camp. So much experience. Worked with Bobby Rahal for many years. There's Andy Lally.
That's good news. See him out of the car. And you're talking about the Turner team. They've got plenty of wins, but for Jens Klingman and Brett Curtis, their first wins. And Brett's been a supporter of that team for a long time. That's absolutely fantastic.
Well, as the Pro-Am driver, the silver-graded driver in that car, that's up to those guys to really step up. GTD has got so competitive this year, and it's all about the driver pairings. And he has done a mega job. He really takes it very seriously, works hard at his game. So Brett Curtis, congratulations, along with Jens Klingman.
You know what? I was talking about Cameron standing alone. Well, he came in tied with Colin Brown. Oh. And guess what? Colin got a win, too. So right back to the top, Colin and Jonathan Bennett in that car. So it's still a three-way tie for most wins in the history of the IMSA WeatherTech Championship. But for Dane Cameron and Eric Kern, how sweet this one is. And they're enjoying every minute of it. As they come by, and then the 67 for Briscoe and Westbrook. And what a birthday present for Richard Westbrook. His birthday today, his 39th again.
Again.
For Richard, absolutely phenomenal. Third straight win for that car in IMSA WeatherTech Championship competition.
That was all about strategy. Just a great call there. I say great call. When you got poor track position, it's sometimes easy to make those calls because it's a no-brainer. You got nothing to lose. When you're leading or you're up front, you get one of those cautions that's in a weird time.
And Dane enjoying the moment, lighting him up here. Gotta love that. I just thought he'd run through the water there and use it like the staging lane in NHRA, which, remember, is next. Don't go anywhere. Here's your top four class winners. We'll hear from them when we come back. The Mobil 1 Sports Car Grand Prix is complete, a race chock full of intrigue and some absolutely phenomenal racing moments, culminating with this trip by Dane Cameron down in to Victory Circle. But, Cal, maybe it was all precipitated by what is our Audi move of the race.
Well, within his first 20 seconds of getting in the race car, coming out of pit lane, you can see the race here. 55 car had a bobble. The 5 car follows them out. But watch Dan Cameron. He leaves the pit lane, gets an acceleration run when he can, and then he puts it all on the line here. Everyone on cold tires. Look at the apex here. He's going to dive into the dirt here, whatever's necessary, nearly contact. But then he's got his teammate up ahead. Puts it to the outside, tries to find grip, completes the pass, and that really set up the rest of the day.
And he climbs out of that Whelan Engineering Team Fox Corvette DP. Justin, big celebrations for them in Victory Circle.
Massive celebrations here. Dane, your first victory, you finally conquered this amazing racetrack.
I know, finally. I think I finished third here at least three times. We were so close last year, Eric and I, so feels great to finally get this win here at Canadian Tire Motorsport Park. I think long overdue for the 31 Whelan Corvette this year. We've been so close, slipped through our fingers a couple times, so really great to drive this one home.
And of course, we were talking just 20 minutes ago, Eric. This is great for the team, great for Sonny Whelan, his family, but also for you. You put the car right up there in the position. Great job.
Yeah, it just feels awesome. I mean, yeah, hats off to Sonny Whelan, Whelan Engineering. All the Action Express guys nailed it. Another 1-2 finish. We're in a good place points-wise, and I've won a few races here in the Whelan colors, so it's nice to bring it back on the top step. Dane did an amazing job. I think we got the best team, we got the best crew, we got the best Whelan Engineering Corvette, and I got the best co-driver, so we couldn't be happier, and hats off to our teammates in second.
Big smiles, big celebrations. Jamie?
Big smiles and celebrations. Don't stop over there. Three wins in a row for the number 67 team. Ryan Briscoe, you brought the car to the checkered flag. Someone would have told you 3 days ago you guys would have been able to turn this into a victory. Would you have thought so?
I mean, 3 days ago, maybe. 2 days ago when we started practice, no way. I mean, we were way off the pace, but we tuned on it. You know, we tuned on it, and in the end, the strategy got us the win. Great job by Goldberg and Ryan up in up on the stand. Great job by Westy there. Qualifying was great. I did not think we were going to win today. We were going to give it our all, but must be the birthday blessing for Westy here.
You mentioned the strategy. The team's certainly giving it their all. We were a bit concerned on the fuel at the end of the race. You were sitting on the pit cart. What was the level of concern for you?
Uh,
zero, actually. No, fuel wasn't a concern. I mean, we came in for a splash, and it worked out really well for us. But it was such a good call. But Ryan still had an incredible job to do. You know, we were on older tyres than anyone else, and not having the fastest car, so we're not complaining. But to hang on like he did was amazing. So, I mean, we got so much momentum, three on a bounce, it's just crazy.
Well, happy birthday, guys, and congratulations.
Thank you.
Justin?
Well, two very happy guys here. Brilliant job, because they brought the 96 BMW, Turner BMW, through to the front. That was an extraordinary run there for you. You're sweating a bit, which is good for a young factory driver.
Yeah, it was a tough one. I mean, the car was all weekend long, was just one of the fastest. And then I was stuck behind Blekemolen, behind the Viper. He was really quick, so I knew it was a tough call to come by. Then I was lucky on the traffic, so yeah, it paid out really well, but I was sweating because we lost the rear a little. And also on the straight line, we were just lacking the power and the top speed, so it's very hard to overtake and very difficult. But yeah, man, it's really, it's the first victory for us, at least for me, in the States, and that makes me really proud, the new car. So let's hope for some more trophies in the future.
Smiles all around down here, guys.
Yeah, those wipers were quick.
Yes, they were, no question. And let's get right back down to Jamie with a big win in Prototype Challenge.
Well, Colin Braun and John Bennett called this backwards day before the start of the race. Colin, you qualified the car, elected to start John in it, but then you brought it back and you finished the race. What factor did the strategy have in the win today?
It was huge. You know, we got my dad, Jeff, on the box, and then Colin Mason. Both those guys came up with a kind of crazy strategy, but obviously it worked out. I mean, those guys did a great job on the strategy. The core boys did a great job in the pits, and you know, we were able to hold on and just keep the car kind of in contention all day. The pit strategy cycled through, and we found ourselves with a nice little lead. And, you know, the Continental tires held up, and we were able to win the race. So certainly kind of textbook and a big payoff for the guys. They worked their butts off flipping us to a new car or a spare car for this weekend. So a good payoff for those guys. Really proud of them.
Now, John, you certainly won a tight ship, as they say. Your guy's always top-notch when it comes to pit work and mechanical work as well. But you had to start at the back of the PC grid. It's so tight. What was that like for you today?
I mean, it's you're right. It's not a great neighborhood to start the race off in, but you know, the job is to attack and get Colin in a position to finish the race in P1. And my hat is absolutely off to our team. It's been back-to-back weekends, and it hasn't been easy for them. And yeah, P1.
Congratulations.
Thanks, guys.
He did. What a drive that was, and a great strategy call, as you said. They're pretty elated. Let's take a look at our BMW race results. And there you see it. Cameron and Kern getting the overall win, and in Prototype Challenge, the number 54 of Colin Braun and Bennett. And the interesting stories in each there is the points. Obviously, Braun and Bennett are way down, and we'll look at that in just a minute. But, boy, they just needed that, I think, just for the team in general here to be able to get back in the game. Now let's take a look at those prototype driver points. We showed you at one point it was down to two, ends up at four.
Yeah, it was a big swing there by the Barbosa Fittipaldi car getting ahead of the Taylor boys. So you can see there, 4 points between the two Action Express cars. Taylors have a lot of work to do. 9 points, a lot of ground to make up with just three rounds remaining.
And GT Le Mans points, there you see it now. And that margin continues to shrink from 9 to 5. That Chevy and Ford battle, wow, it is spectacular. Let's get back down to Justin Bell.
Well, yeah, it is spectacular. Jan Magnussen and Antonio Garcia, you're sitting in the right place. I mean, you're in the right spot here, Antonio. You might as well get in early. The GT battle is now starting to come into this amazing situation where everyone is running hard against each other. That looked like a very tough race.
Yeah, indeed. I mean, no matter where you are, we saw different cars in the lead or mixing positions all the way. It's a shame we led 2/3 of the race. I mean, that was, and then, yeah, it was all due to the last pit stop, I believe. I mean, we were the only ones probably doing the driver change and a little bit longer than the other two guys. I mean, especially the car that won, they gambled on fuel. But, I mean, that put me in a very difficult situation with Tommy. He was on warm tires, and yeah, I mean it's a 2-3 for Corvette, so I think it's a really good bounce back.
Yeah, on reflection, hindsight is always 20/20, right, guys?
It is that, and I'll tell you, it was a great run. Good to see that battle. The car is obviously very close. Let's take a look at our Continental Tire race recap. You see at the end the class leaders, 3 cautions for 7 laps, 10 lead changes overall, and only a couple of cars out of the race. Cal, next race in the championship in 2 weeks, we aren't going to be seeing the prototype cars, but the other 3 classes at Lime Rock.
Well, the battles we saw today will be intensified there on that bullring of a racetrack. Just great action here. It's always wonderful to come north of the border to this race circuit. Congratulations to Ron Fellows and the whole group there. Again, they put on a great show.
And that race will be live on Fox, so make sure you tune in and stay right here on FS1. NHRA action up next. Thanks for joining us, everybody.